Ladies and gentlemen, may I present for your intellectual and philosophical pleasure?
Run Fez on Raw Dog.
Raw Dog.
Comedy Hits. Channel 99.
Raw Fez. Run Fez. Hey.
Okay, let's get down to it, boppers.
Yeah, buddies, it's the Ron and Fez show. Our first show back of the new year. Today is Friday. I'm going to guess March 6th. Give us a call at 866-RON-0-FEZ, 866-RON-0-FEZ. I haven't been on the air for 2 hours today. It's taken 2 hours. And then I look up. And look who's here. It's our own Molly Bean. Molly.
Hey, everyone.
You tiny little thing. I don't know what's happening to in college.
Eating right.
I'm going to guess drugs. I guess you got in with a bad crowd. Coke or meth?
Both.
That could actually be like a speed.
Oh.
Who's this with you?
This is my best friend on the planet Earth. And in the entire universe, Liz.
Hi, everyone. We were roommates.
Well, here's the thing,
back
Liz.
Back in the day.
Liz, I feel like you and I are going to be competitive because I used to be Molly's best friend
Okay. Before
you met her. But you guys used to be roommates.
Yeah.
And Molly said a lot of times that you guys would be up late at night telling each other secrets and practicing kissing.
Every day. That's the only way that you can practice.
Now,
How else would we practice?
In college, you guys just got put together in a...
Sort of.
In a dorm room?
I was supposed to be with another girl, and she never showed up to school, so I like waited around for her for 2 days, and then I realized that she wasn't coming, so Liz was in a forced triple with two girls who were really mean to her and kicked her out of the room, so she...
Why were they mean to you?
Because they already knew each other in high school, so they had that, and no one wants to be in a forced triple. It's forced. It's the name forced is in it for a reason. It's a very small space, three girls. They wanted me out because they knew each other already.
You know, the forced triple was any girl that I was actually dating at the time. I go, no, you're doing this. I need it, and you need it, and it's going to open up your horizons, too.
You're going to love it.
Yeah. And sometimes I don't even care if I sit back and smoke. And I'm just close while it's all happening. But that was a different time before this accepted time that we live in.
Yes.
But Molly was nice to you right away?
Of course.
That's nice.
Of course. We got along right away.
I prepped all the girls on our hall for when Liz was going to come because I really wanted a roommate. And I knew the only reason why she wouldn't live with me would be because she didn't like me. Like, she was living in this terrible situation. So I was like, ladies, Liz is going to come, be on your best behavior. And then she...
Molly, why do you got to organize and run everything, no matter how small it is?
Micromanagement. It's
yes. What is that about? What is that control issues about being left alone with the Spanish nanny?
Right.
Was that
Filipina,
it?
But yes. Oh.
Filipinas to me seem part Spanish.
Yes, she can speak a little Spanish.
Yeah.
Because, the Philippines was a...
Spanish colony?
Yeah, Spanish colony.
Mm. See, I should be in college. The way I came up with Spanish college colony that fast. Now, what is your major there?
I'm a communications major.
Oh, what a wasted degree.
Oh, no.
We don't need anyone else. We're done.
Who can communicate?
Yeah.
You don't need that. You're right.
No one else wants to ever move on, so all the positions are done. By the way, I keep looking up at the Boston bombing trial while you guys are sitting here. I guess that's the big buzz up there,
yeah, there's
huh?
a lot of buzz.
That and whoever the Patriots kill at the time. and also this year... you're, I think, 2 inches away for the most snow Boston's ever had.
It's been insane.
Yeah.
There are people are snowboarding down mountains of snow that, like, have been created by these plows, and, like, the T is still not 100% running. It's a disaster.
They don't know where to put the snow.
Yeah, that's been a big problem.
They have these giant snow-melting machines, and they just, like, kind of collect the water in a basin, and then I imagine them, like, watering a beautiful garden with it.
It's very poetic.
Or making new hockey rinks for Boston people.
Yeah.
We just added another 8 hockey rinks, so that's good for everybody. When's the next scandal of who the church molested? This is the things that they talk about in Boston.
Yep. Yeah.
But it's good now. You guys are on your break right now.
Yes.
And yet you're still hanging together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's nice.
Of course. Yeah, we were tired of traveling because we were both abroad, so I came back here. Liz is from New Hampshire, and then she came down to visit.
Where were you abroad?
I was in Paris.
How was it?
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Stunning. Even in the rain, it's pretty. It was great. I didn't like my university that much, to be honest, but I lived with this old couple that were very Catholic, very traditional, very kind, though, but it was a cool experience.
So you were another forced triple when you think about it.
Exactly. I really was. It follows me everywhere.
This could be a great thing for your book, The Forced Triple.
The Forced Triple. Yeah.
It's just a picture of you with two shadows behind you,
yeah,
like looking down like, we're not getting along with you.
No, this will haunt me.
By the way, this is Fez. He's not saying anything today because I guess a little nervous, Fez?
A little nervous today, yeah.
That's different. He suffers from nerves.
Don't we all?
Yeah. Well, I know, but he doesn't want to hear that. He wants to hear that his is worse than everyone else's.
Oh.
That he's uniquely tortured. Uniquely tortured.
Okay.
Yeah, be scared.
I am. Wow.
It is like Jinx. He is like the TV show Jinx that we were talking about today on Bennington. Here is Derek. Derek in New Jersey. Go ahead, Derek.
Roddy B, $1 million, my man.
$1 million.
Hey, I'm calling in. I wanted to be Fez's first black friend. I think he needs that. You know, sometimes you got to verify.
Well, I feel like if Fez has made it this far without black friends, I don't think he wants to start now.
I'm probably going to go the rest of the way without it.
But you can go to the next level. You know, someone calls you a racist, you can say, hey, wait a minute, I have a black friend, and I could be that guy to value.
Racist is the least of my concerns about what people call me.
What's the first?
All right,
the other F word.
But you're not gay. That's the beauty of it. You never have to. You could always explain to them, I'm never did anything. You know, I used to like to go into clubs, and I would call black people and say, come with me. And then I got caught out on that by Bonnie McFarlane, who said to me, and I'll never forget, what year is this? And I go, it's the 70s. And we're busing. Because I like the idea of having a black friend to say, hey, this is a black guy. Me and him are coming in for cocktails. I know, it seems crazy. But now that's no longer a big thing. What is, like, the weirdest connect? I guess soon we'll have to have, like, a robot friend. Like, you'll be saying, look, Dad, he's a robot, but I love him. I mean, is there anything that's edgy now?
Maybe, like, a bisexual.
A bisexual?
If I was bringing home a bisexual boyfriend, I feel like that would be edgy, don't you?
Oh, yeah. Because our parents would be, they'd be like, wait, so you're with him, but he would still be interested in a man.
Do you guys talk about liking the same people?
What if you brought him home with his boyfriend? And
that
say,
would be edgy.
That'd
be a forced triple.
Unless he was like, oh, that's gross. And then it would just be like he's with one and with the other.
It would be kind of like The Bachelor.
Yes.
Never see it.
Ugh.
Ugh.
Is it good or terrible?
It is a... Well, I don't want to call it a quality program.
No.
But I think it's the most entertaining show on TV.
I don't like reality shows because of the lack of reality.
That's the least real show also. They have, like, you know, they go on group dates. That's just, like, not a concept in real life.
It doesn't happen that way.
Yeah.
Or if you like 6 girls, but you're like, the 7th one doesn't get the rose. And, like, seriously, if someone said to you in life, I'm deciding between you and five other girls. Congratulations. I mean, if that doesn't end with a fuck you, I don't know what would.
Yeah.
At what point?
It's so entertaining, though. I think it has something for everybody.
Yeah.
It has, like, beautiful women for men. It has, like, a really good-looking guy for women. It's, you know, if you're into, like, sports, it has some athletic aspects.
Mm. Yeah, they have challenges every week sometimes.
I didn't know that they have challenges.
Oh, yeah. Big time.
So the guy will say, look, whoever runs through these tires gets to date me?
Well, yeah. This time he's a farmer. And so they have like tractor farming related challenges.
They had a tractor race. They had one where you had to like milk a cow. So
why wouldn't someone say, wait a minute, I thought you were going to be a billionaire. You're a farmer. I'm out. I'm going to come back next time when someone is a software engineer.
Yeah, they went. All the women went back to his hometown in Iowa. And there's like one store. And they were all they hated it. And then they got back to him and they were like, it was so charming and cute.
It was so nice. There was nothing to do.
Yeah.
I could go to bed at 7 and feel bad about myself. This is why a lot of people out in the heartland, America's heartland, take oxys. Because why shouldn't they at that point? Just down yourself out. You'll learn this as the years go by. When you start to die inside and unfortunately the heart keeps beating.
Is that you?
No, it was me. I'm actually reborn from that.
Nice.
Thanks to Jesus. And I'm going to say this because you're a Jew, so you know Christ is his last name. Is there a Christ here? Jesus Christ? That was Jesus in school. I'd like to do a fun cartoon for kids, Jesus the early years.
Yeah.
You know?
Like growing up.
What about teenage Jesus?
Teen Jesus, if you look at him, he was either a swimmer or on the diving team. I mean, he really came into his own. But wouldn't it be great to have Mary like, Jesus, are you using your powers again? You know we want to keep them under wraps from the Romans.
He'd be popular at parties, just, hey, nobody has any wine here, do they? And then suddenly, everywhere.
Yeah, he was the life of the party.
Well, he could get served. Jesus can get served, but no one sees him do it.
Whoa.
They see him leave with the money that I guess he pockets. And then comes back with wine that he made out of, you know, rain. Would you like it to rain wine? That would have really been great. It's just raining wine from up high. And now Jesus is going to lie. You know what I always like about those stories, though, is people still wouldn't believe them after they even saw the miracles.
Yeah.
Like he would do a miracle, but people would be like, yeah, that one miracle you would do, but I don't think you're really the Son of God. But he was in great shape.
Yeah.
Of course. He did a lot of walking.
Good point.
Yeah. On water also, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Never jogged.
Probably not.
Yeah.
Do you think he was angsty about it? Like, do you think that he was sort of resistant to the fact that he couldn't really, like, be his best self?
I think he had acne.
No.
You don't think so?
That would be, has never came up. Like, Jesus has a pimple.
He healed leprosy. I can't imagine that he wouldn't, you know, do an overnight thing on his zit.
I'm glad that you brought that up too, Fez, because I think that that's what they thought acne was back then.
Oh.
They're like, oh, he's leprosy. And you're like, no, I'm 15. I'm just going through a really oily time.
You think he would get all that sand from the area and have like a nice sand scrub for himself?
Oh, exfoliate, yes.
Yeah.
From the area. Although they say there wasn't as much sand back then. I mean, he was a carpenter, and if you look over there, there's not a lot of trees that he could have had.
That would have probably been why he's in such good shape. There's no power tools either. Like, he really had to work that saw.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
Yeah, he would definitely be doing that. But I will tell you this. I mean, for being a carpenter, I don't think he ever did any major work. Probably just end tables. You know what I mean? Like, you would have thought if he would have built something large, it would still be around.
Yeah, that whoever had that would think, this is a Jesus Christ original.
Yeah.
Like, this will be valuable.
Oh, can you imagine if you had that at your house? Just like a beautiful coffee table done by Jesus. You're like, don't put anything down on that. That's Jesus's. People would come by all the time, want to pray in front of it. But you never hear of any work that he did.
I think he did, like, for, like, high school plays, he would volunteer and make, like,
you know what? You're being blasphemous. We're being serious about this. You're being blasphemous. I mean, I would hope he didn't just do spice racks. I wish he did some major work.
Maybe he whittled, too. Maybe it was kind of like he was a sculptor.
But I never thought of him
carpenter.
That way as a whittler.
Yeah, I think
just
he was.
Just sitting out with nothing.
On the front porch.
Just whittling.
With a hound.
What is it? Small cross. No. No, wear this.
They were such a small operation, I can't imagine that they got some big contract orders.
What, Joseph and Sons?
Yeah.
Was the dad in on the business, too?
Yeah, that's who taught him to be a carpenter. Because that's how people used to get jobs then, just immediately from their dads.
Yeah.
You know, rather than just a handout like we do now, you would go to work with your dad. Like, if this, you would probably be a sax player.
I would be his apprentice.
Yes, you would be your dad's apprentice sax player.
Oh, man.
Has your dad got any big gigs coming up?
No, he was up in Connecticut playing a gig last weekend, but yeah, nothing really big. The winter is a slower time for jazz. He sort of just sits out the window. And
I did not know that this winter people don't like jazz.
I think that there's a slower time for jazz live performance.
Yeah, because people prefer their outdoor in the park jazz.
Yeah, I think so. I seriously think that.
Here's Sean. Sean, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, Ronnie, but didn't we learn at one time that Jesus invented the chair?
Well, Dave tried to tell us, and he did this seriously, that before Jesus, there were only stools, and he invented the chair back. And he goes, there's no chairs. And I go, what about thrones? And then he goes, and then he said, well, regular people did not have, you know, it's like a personal computer. Like when you really think about it, Wozniak didn't invent a computer, just a computer you could have at your house, you know? So he felt like, you know, I guess the chair back called a portable throne at the time, but there's no historical information that he was right about that. But you would have, see, I think more people would believe if Jesus would have, like while he was preaching, if he would have said, oh, and there used to be dinosaurs, and there's Indians now. They're on the other side of the planet. Yeah, we're on a planet. We're revolving around that sun. Like, if he would have just thrown in some facts that that I could do now if I was taken back in time.
Right.
I'd fucking blow people away. A, with my lighter right off the bat. Sun God. What's your name? Sun God. Tiny Sun God. But that would have been very helpful. There's nothing that you ever get in, but like, thinking, oh, Jesus was ahead of his time.
Was he psychic?
If he did, he didn't use it that way.
I know.
Now, he knew psychics, right, Fez?
Yeah.
What did they call them back? They were seers, right?
Oracles?
They were prophets. Mm. Prophets, and the term they used was hero.
See, I disagree that a prophet is a futurist. You know what I mean? Because they only say, oh, a god is coming, and that'll be, but they're not saying, oh, and people also have cars. Before that happens.
They said, like, for individual people's situations, they would say, like, oh, you know, like, for Oedipus, that, like, you're going to kill your father and marry your mother. Like, that was a prophecy.
Somebody said that to Oedipus?
Yeah. It's crazy.
That I didn't know.
And it came true.
See, I never got much into that story past having sex with your mom. I was like, wait, go back to that party again.
That stuck with you.
Is this stepmom? Because when Fez was younger, and I just found this out today, he and his uncle used to play incest tag.
What is that?
Well, you don't want to know. Incest. They would run around tagging each other in an incestuous way.
Like, if you don't know about it, that just proves no one else ever played it.
Well, not necessarily. Maybe she's just like comes from a good family.
It was called incest tag?
That's what they called it, him and his uncle. Time for incest tag. Jason, Panic in Detroit. You're on Ron Fed.
Hey, Ronnie. Just want to know if Molly's roommate that knows that she's Molly the singer and has recorded that hit single, The Dinosaur Song.
Well, yes. Molly was a prodigy as a child. We have that ready to go. This is Molly. How old were you here, Molly? 15, 16 years old?
I was like four or five.
5 years old.
The lone dinosaur, his tail was swift as lightning, dinosaur, His heart was brave and pure. Died so whenever there was danger, he'd be there to fight the carnival. The Lord Dinosaur.
Well, you threw yourself into the end of that, though.
The Lone Dinosaur.
Steve, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, sorry if I'm peeing on anyone's parade, but Jesus was not necessarily a carpenter. The original word in the Greek language, which is in the ancient manuscripts, is tekton, which just means laborer.
So he just carried block?
Well, he might have been somebody who carved wood or fashioned lumber, but that doesn't mean that he was a carpenter.
So you're just saying he was a day laborer, maybe not so much Jesus, but Jesus. You know, like, hey, before you guys jump in the back of this truck.
Yeah, I went to Bible school, so I know what I'm talking about.
Well, Fez taught Bible school. Is there truth to this, Fez?
I always heard Jesus was a carpenter. A carpenter who was the son of a carpenter.
The other thing that never comes up much is that he was a Capricorn. And that had a lot to do with his personality.
Look at Vine's Greek Dictionary and you'll know exactly
Pictionary?
What I'm talking
about. No, I'm not going to look at a Pictionary. Here's Josh in Los Angeles, California, hey, home of the Doors.
Hey, guys. Good morning.
Hey.
Hey. So a couple of things. First of all, I think the word you were looking for a futurist back then was either an oracle or a soothsayer.
I like that one.
Yeah. That one. And then Jesus actually, so I went to Creighton University out in Omaha, so I had to learn the history of the Bible. So there are non-canonical gospels. Books that were thrown out when they were compiling the original Bible, and they've got Jesus the Kid stories in there. So you can find these non-canonical gospels. My favorite story, Jesus got pissed off at another kid. He banished him, but he banished him to the top of a roof of a house. The kid falls down off the roof, falls to his death. His mom says, hey, that was a naughty thing to do. So Jesus says, oh, sorry, Mom, and brings him back to life.
Yeah, well, these are the things that did not make it in the Bible. That
uncut.
Yeah, it's, well, sometimes you shoot more than you need. And some of the stuff they had to edit out. But maybe it'll be on the DVD version of the Bible.
Hidden bonus tracks.
Mm. It's like when they made that Young Indiana Jones show. That's like sort of the Bible's version of that.
The here's the thing about Jesus, and I know, Molly, that you're a happy and healthy, somewhat of a Jew. You pick and choose your Jewish things to be part of.
Yeah.
Anything I ever hear about Jesus, I like. But I don't like any of his fans. And, like, for me, Jesus is like Dave Matthews, where I can't make it through his obnoxious fans and time to really give the music a good listen.
Yeah.
If I heard about Jesus in a vacuum, I'd probably like him a lot better if I didn't hear somebody yelling about it in a super church, mega church. But Fez, you grew up in the church, right?
Yeah, yeah. All of my childhood and adult life. Well, not all of my adult life. I'm still living. But a big part of it.
You're surviving, but are you living?
No.
And none of it ever seemed weird to you?
No, because in Sunday school, I once questioned a Bible story and got in so much trouble that I said, I will never bring that up again, even as a little kid.
Do you remember what you questioned?
It was Moses parting the Red Sea. Because we heard the whole story, and the Sunday school teacher said that Moses used his staff to reach out over the sea. And I said, I don't understand that. How can someone just point a stick and a sea parts in half?
You should have been screamed at for that.
I was.
Good.
I was humiliated in front of the class, and then my father screamed at me after the Sunday school teacher ratted me out.
But say we're right, you should not question that. You should just go, oh, Steph. Gotcha. I'll write that down.
Big stick.
Steph.
So, no, after that, I really just took it all, you know, as it was fact. Everybody else in the church seemed to be doing it. I didn't hear anyone ever question anything, not even adults in adult Bible class.
Well, why would you question anything? You have faith or you don't have faith. You present it with, I mean, if it was logic, you're not going to get it. This isn't a game of logic. It's a game of faith. Just believe. Do not question.
It was before the Billy Joel song, Keeping the Faith, though, so he didn't know what he should do then. It was like before the 80s.
Well, he did keep the faith.
Yeah, but he heard it.
First of all, people
it.
Had faith before Billy Joel, just so you
didn't.
Get that. Yeah, I mean, obviously he added to everyone's faith, but before that people had faith. But, you know, there is a thing, you can't just say, well, wait, that one sounds ridiculous, because it all is. You either have to go all the way in with religion or not at all. Now, for me, for Catholic kids, we go like this, back and forth with each other, about the same time you figured out Santa Claus. As soon as you figure out Santa Claus, you're going like this. You know what? I think there's another Santa Claus. But you keep it going in front of the adults. You don't yell shit out in front of them.
That was my mistake.
Yeah. You just keep it quiet, and then you go like this. Yeah, Mom, I'm going to church, and then you have extra money when she gives you money. We used to either call it Our Lady of Dunkin' Donuts.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Or you just hang out at the laundromat and make out.
At the laundromat?
Well, because romantic. The laundromat would be warm in the winter, so you could meet your girlfriend there and make out.
But it wasn't, like, private or anything. Right.
Yeah, I mean what do you need to be private for? You at that age, you want people to see you kissing.
Yeah.
When you're in 7th and 8th grade, public makeout is where it's at.
We had Sunday school teachers that...
Even now, if I smell lint, I get a little excited. I'm sorry, stepped on it. Tell us, what happened with your Sunday school teachers?
They kept basically a payroll book in the class with the money you were supposed to bring to Sunday school for your offering. As you turned it in, they would write it down in a ledger.
That's crazy.
And then if for some reason you kept your Sunday school money... Yeah, that was jotted down, and it was duly noted. And kids who didn't bring it, like, week after week, it was announced in front of the class, you haven't brought your offering in 3 weeks.
Do you... You had to pay an offering? You have to pay an offering?
Yeah. You got special little kid envelopes to put it in.
Hmm. Well, did you have to bring extra for what you said about the staff? One more question there, teacher. Did Moses have a staph infection or what? Am I right, guys? We got her on the ropes. Everybody backing me up here. Little Fez Watley, you have brought so much embarrassment to this family with that staph joke of yours. How big was his staph and was it thick? You're disgusting, little Fez Watley. Live in sin. I remember when, like, they would even say, because we have mortal sins and all that, and they'd be like, if you miss church, that's a mortal sin, so you're going to, you know, burn for that. And you're like, for one day? How are you going to burn for?
What, you know? Was there a different categorization of, like, mortal versus another type of sin?
It was a venial sin, and then you, because some of it would just send you to purgatory, which is where you would burn in hell, but you would get out eventually.
Oh, okay.
So that was... That was a really nice thought for a kid. Like, I will burn, but maybe for 200 years, not forever. Yeah, I'll take about 200 years burn for that. Smoking? Sure. Why not?
Was there one type of sin that you were just like, you were going to be in purgatory and burn forever no matter what?
Well, it wouldn't be purgatory. Then you would go to hell. The unforgivable sin is suicide.
Oh.
That's the first thing that they would tell you when you're a kid. If you basically, you're not getting out of this. So if you kill yourself, you're really in trouble. Because they don't want you to escape life. Hang around where we can yell at you and hit you with stuff.
Take your money.
Yeah. But suicide was always the big one. And then, of course, you know, any of the top 10, you know, the Billboard top 10. all the thou shall nots.
Stealing would get you in hell forever?
Stealing, yeah, and little kids steal a lot. No, obviously, if you accept, basically on your deathbed, you need to make sure you accept. What you need to do is get a confession, communion, and a whole clean soul. Because if you go to confession, you're free of everything.
Oh.
You've done your penance. So you basically are soulless and able to take the blood of Christ in your in communion. But what you don't want to do is die at a time before you had that happen. You really want to time it so you had a priest there on your deathbed, clear you out, then you die. And that person, let's say if Hitler said, I am sorry for what I did, accept Christ, he would go on to heaven why a nice person who didn't do that would burn for it.
That doesn't seem right.
Look, here's the thing. It's a system. Work the system as good as you can. That's the thing. There's keys to winning a system.
You're kind of gambling, though, because if you live a life of sin and you're not, you know, you're not 100% sure when you're going to die, but you're counting on that last 5 minutes with the priest to clear your life of sin. Like, I feel like that's pretty risky.
All right, but suppose you have a priest as a brother and you're hanging around him a lot. That's a great move. But, like, if now I would go, Clara, I could be back in the good graces very, very quickly.
What if you? What if you're on your deathbed? You get communion, and you're cleared of your charges for sin, and then you have like a really impure thought right before you die.
You're fucked. Oh, you can't have an impure thought.
Wow.
Carlin did a whole bit on that. Is that's the impure thought was a sin, and then doing it was a sin. You know, and each thing that you did that led to it. So, like, if you were going to say, I'm going to rob the liquor store, what do I need? And right away, that's a sin. Then what do I need? I need a mask. That's a sin. I need to get a gun. That's a sin. I need a driver. That's a sin. So you would really rack up your sins just on the way to go down and rob a liquor store.
So you couldn't pull a fast one on God with suicide and do like a suicide by cop because he would be able to read your mind and know you were kind of do it on purpose.
It's a great question. Could you do a suicide by cop? yeah, because God can read your mind. But there is so much honor in getting killed by a cop that I think that, and this is me, you know, taking it on my own, I think you'd be fine with it. I think any priest would say, look, a cop killed him? That's not a suicide. I mean, he's just a guy that didn't want to go back to jail.
That's Jeremy Renner in the town. He's hanging out in heaven now.
Well, he belongs in heaven.
It seems like a pill suicide, you could get away with it a lot easier. You take all the pills to kill yourself, then you confess your sin.
You're
it's too late. The pills are taking effect. You confess your sin, do everything else you need to do, and clear that up, and you can't stop the death.
But you would had to, while you're doing that thing, you would have to get up and try to stop the death. You'd have to go for a stomach pump.
Also, wouldn't even the act of preparing for the confession part be a sin because were planning to die?
But Fez is saying you could do a confession, but then you'd have to tell the priest. He'd probably say, here's what you need to do. You know, you got to go get your stomach pumped right now. Then I think if you did that, if you're trying to get your stomach pumped, pass. I'll give him a pass in heaven. I would love the job as St. Peter, to be able to go like this. Well, here's the good news, Shelby. You're not getting eternal burning, but you're going to get 7,000 years of burning. And then you'll be out. Do your time wisely.
All right, thanks, Peter. I guess that's not too bad.
It's Ron. Why are you calling me Peter?
He learned nothing during those 7,000 years.
Here's Paul. Paul, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, Ron. Hey, Fez. A second ago, you had mentioned, don't mean to correct you, about Hitler, but he had actually shot himself. So if he committed suicide, whether he repented or not, he wouldn't get in, right?
Well, I use Hitler as an example of the worst person that we could all think of.
Okay.
Now, obviously, he's going to go to hell for being a Protestant to begin with. Because what's the point of going to heaven if it's going to be filled with fucking proddies?
That's true. I have one question, though. Does anyone know where centaurs go when they die?
866-RON-0-FEZ, 866-RON-0-FEZ. Hey, Jay, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, it's Jay Bone. I wanted to know if Molly and her girlfriend ever go to Moogie's up there. Right?
Oh, awesome. We do Moogie's.
Moogie's is a sandwich place?
Yes.
Yeah, they have something called the Where's Waldo. Nutella.
Ron,
bananas.
My favorite for you would be the mother and child reunion.
Oh my gosh, that's what I usually get.
Nice like a mother and child reunion. Why aren't we singing that song right now as we're looking over Moogie's?
Yeah, Moogie's is really great little spot. The rest of the campus over there, there's nothing else, but that's a good little spot. Right
it's
there.
A great little spot. It's a little gem.
It's not a chain?
No, it's like this old school kind of, they play really good music, it's sandwiches, it's like a counter, it's a lot of students hang out there, like local people. It's
you can watch games there if there's a game on.
Yeah, they have dollar drafts sometimes.
What would I give you false hope on this strange and more?
mine. I can't for the life of me remember a Saturday. I know they say let it be, it just won't work out that way. In the course of a lifetime runs over and over again. No, I would not give you false hope on this strange and mournful day. But the mother and child reunion is only a motion away.
You know, I gotta figure something out here. How come in New York City they have it named streets after Paul Simon or buildings or parks? I would have no problem changing the name Central Park to Paul Simon Park.
I would do it in a heart.
And then I got to have like a little playground for our golf uncle. I can't, you know, leave him out completely.
Inside of Paul Simon Park?
Yeah.
He doesn't even get his own space.
Well, what should he have? I mean,
a bench.
Brutal. Give him
I kind of feel like if it was Simon and Bennington, we would have done just as well. I wouldn't say that. Art was in here one day. He was just a lovely man.
I think Catholic Joe played him in ping pong when he was here.
Probably did.
I heard that story.
You still seeing Catholic Joe much?
No, not really, because I've been up in Boston. But when I'm here, I see him. You know, we say hi.
He's a good man.
Yeah, he's a good kid.
He's a good Catholic.
Yes.
He's going straight to heaven.
Maybe.
No, he got me. Why? Because he smokes marijuana? I'm not going to judge somebody like that.
Well, I'm not judging him, but, you know, you said you got to play by the rules, right? All the rules.
There's nothing in the Bible at all about marijuana.
Well, isn't there something about drugs?
Yes, yeah, smoke up. Smoke up, Johnny.
420, blaze it.
Enjoy yourself. Oh, I'm thinking of the Jamaican Bible. Please stop it with the Paul Simon. He's driving me nuts. Last thing I needed him is just singing in my ear the entire day. Coming up a little later on in the phone. Yeah, because the show is a phone. That's why I said that. I know I'll get to heaven. That's true. Maybe because of what I've done here on Earth to help human beings by entertaining them while they're listening to the radio.
Yeah.
You think you said phone because you forgot yours? That's like all you're thinking about?
No, you freaked me out because I don't have a phone. I'm living like an Apache right now. I'm just going to start a fire and hit it with a blanket so I can ask my chick what time's dinner.
Huh? There must have been so much miscommunication back then.
Sure. It's constant. Honey, the smoke's on. Help me, I'm on fire. I'm burning. Oh, little daughter of mine. Millie Hatchett, how you doing, darling?
Hey there, how are you?
Cool.
Okay, so like when you're 5 years old and you're waiting for your sixth birthday, it seems like an eternity. I don't get how we can put kids in church and expect them to understand the concept of eternity in hell or heaven or wherever.
You know, when you really think about it, because the church is built around the fact that the sacrifice that Jesus gave through his time. And when you think that he had eternity on both sides of that, I don't know if it's that big of a deal to him. What he did.
And only 33 years here, though. Yeah. Only 33 years on Earth.
33 years, and let's face it, only about the last week was bad. I mean, other than that, he was a nice, slim guy with a beautiful, dramatic beard, you know? He was a good-looking German guy.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Damn Jews killed him.
All right. You know what? Whoever killed him, killed him. It's not that they killed him, but they did point him out. That's him.
It's a different time.
Yeah, it's a different time.
What are you going to do?
But even now, like, I don't know if Jesus even remembers everything about him. I mean, it was 2,000 years ago.
Oh, what's that big 33 years.
Oh, yeah. What are we talking about there? Well, did I die or did I end up going straight to heaven physically? Not even as a soul.
It's brought up about the people who died at age 27, but there should be one for 33. Too.
John Belushi.
Farley, Belushi, Jesus.
33 is a dangerous year.
Yeah.
I felt it at 27, felt it at 24 first for James Dean. There's certain ages that just fuck you up. 24 when you're like, oh shit, James Dean was already done, and I'm an asshole still borrowing money off people on the street. Oh, this doesn't feel good. 27 when you figure Jim Morrison had his entire catalog finished. Oh, that's depressing. And then I think, like, you know, Dylan had written Blowing in the Wind by the time he was 21. Ugh. Larry, Pittsburgh. Larry.
Hey, buddies. I have a question for Mr. Fez Wadley.
Sure.
Hey, you growing up with all that crazy religious shit going on all over you, is that what took you so long to come out of the closet as a gay?
Yeah, it was a big part of it. There was a long time where I realized I was gay, and I was just praying that I wasn't.
That's
and that God would change it.
Quite frankly, I think that worked, Fizz. Because you're not gay.
Oh, that's true. He's not gay, is he?
I think you have to be with someone to be gay.
I agree. So if he was gay, maybe that's what took him so long. But he's not gay.
Are you worried that when you do a gay act, something bad will happen to you?
Not from a God standpoint, like I'll get hit by lightning. I do worry that I'll get so excited I'll have a heart attack.
Well, what makes you think that isn't God doing that? I mean, why would God just use lightning when he could easily just use a tree branch or a train?
Well.
Or make this building fall if he wanted to.
Like, yeah, that's not a good thought at all.
Fuck, Fez, we'd all be falling backwards.
Yeah, right out the side of the building.
Yeah. You know what?
As it toppled.
You know what I would do if it started crashing? Jackknife. Just jackknife from the way down. Like, good form. Or act like I'm rowing a boat. And people are like, dude, I saw this one guy and he was just acting like he was rowing a boat. And giving me a thumbs up. As you go past the other, as you go past the other thing. Yeah! God, that dude was extreme. That dude was extreme. I guess he thought he was going to hit water or something. He was so positive. He stayed light with it all.
I would jump out on a broomstick.
Yeah, hold on. Look, Shelly's losing his shit. You never get to see that often. See, here would be the problem with the broomstick. Are you falling down or is it going that way? So the end of the broom is coming down and you're just going in that direction.
I think the end of the broom is coming down. Like, I would also shout
that song.
As I was going down.
And your little dog, too. Fez, you've been excited about the Larry David next door, the fish in the dark. You've been putting up article after article in the Interrobang.
Yep.
Terrible reviews. Terrible.
Now, this was everything I've read on it. This was the previews people were loving. They were saying it's Larry David as Larry David, which people love. I don't see how it could possibly be a bad play.
Well, maybe people maybe reviewers aren't excited just about seeing people act like themselves.
This is to be contradictory. This is, everyone has showered so much love on this. The thing is completely sold out. There's, for 3 months worth of shows, there's only a couple hundred seats left, and those are matinees. This is reviewers trying to change the tide to get their name in the paper.
Have you ever heard of a great movie that got bad reviews? Just a great movie that was universally panned?
I can't think of one.
Dazed and Confused.
Universally panned?
Got terrible reviews.
Give me the Rotten Tomatoes on that. Quickly, Shelby, quickly. Run, let your fingers take us to Rotten Tomatoes.
I'm telling you, when it first came out, it got totally bombed.
Those things exist
It
came out.
Are you sure?
Yeah,
are you sure that's not in retrospect?
Out. No, go ahead and click on and see if it is at 1992 reviews.
Yep, all 1992.
I'm very embarrassed.
You should be. You're a liar.
I thought...
And it happened in front of Lizard.
Oh. Yeah, I can't live with you ever again. No. I'm sorry.
This is a mistake.
You know what? Liz actually has the perfect voice for a best friend.
Oh, thank you.
You sound like the sounding board voice.
Perfect.
Like, maybe I could check in, like...
If anyone needs that, call me. The best friend.
Yeah. Liz, I don't know if I'm going out with the right person.
Listen, Molly, here's what you need to do. I can help you. Yeah. You're strong and beautiful.
Yes.
That's the perfect best friend voice.
That's the best compliment I've ever gotten.
Yeah. And you know, a lot of times if I have problems, I'll call my best friend. I'll hear this: I'm locked up. That's all.
Liz, I'm gonna do that for now.
Do that again.
Liz, I really jump.
Listen, I can't. That's the perfect impression of him.
Really?
Yes. God. Do it again.
Oh.
Now, Liz. No. Now, Liz, do it right as you're looking at his big dumb mustache.
Oh, I see what's going on.
Thanks for bringing your friends by, Molly.
My name's Fez, and
Fez,
I'm gay. I never had sex. That's the best thing. Seriously, you couldn't have made me any happier. You could have baked banana bread and come in here, and I wouldn't be as happy as I am now.
I'm glad.
She made me granola.
We haven't seen you since the Bobby...
Bobby Slayton.
No, it wasn't Bobby Slayton.
Robert Kelly.
And then I hypnotized Fez at that gig.
Yeah.
And, you know, no one has ever been there, has ever brought it up to us.
What?
Not one person has ever called in on that, but wasn't that crazy?
It was amazing.
And then everybody after, like, Opie and stuff was like, well, what was he? Was he hypnotized or not? And I'm like, why? Why are you even asking? He goes, because he really was confident. Was the hypnotist show before bullshit? I'm going, well, yeah.
It was like, it was a perfect combination of, like, it really felt impromptu, but there was so much, like, there were so many props / like, different elements that were clearly, like, you know, predetermined. It
Here's
was awesome.
What we did. We ran through it once and then jumped on stage.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
We ran through it once and then jumped on stage.
That's awesome.
No table read. Just right to it.
Well, we couldn't because Christine had a bunch of other people hanging around. We wanted to do, you know, to try it out. But I just know a couple of things. A, I wanted to get water in his face because that always gets a laugh. And B, get his pants down because that always gets a laugh.
It was amazing.
Yeah, it was funny, fun night.
It sounded great, like...
And Bobby was like, what the hell was that, groundlings? He would not get the interview started.
Yeah, you kept just being like, and Robert Kelly. Yeah.
Yeah, Robert Kelly. What am I supposed to do, follow that? Okay, Robert Kelly. Here's where we're actually starting. See, you get it.
Yep.
When I look back, once at you and your dad, I just saw you guys like, what?
I was like nervous because... Bobby was swearing a lot, and I was nervous that my dad was going to say something about it, but he didn't at all.
Well, what do you say? It's like, stop the unmasked? I don't want you using that language in front of my daughter.
No, I don't know. To me, being like, oh, he was funny, but there was no caveat. He was just, he loved it.
So funny.
It was really
Your dad's
funny.
The easiest going guy in the world.
He's really easygoing. He's really easygoing.
All right, let's break here. Molly and Liz are sitting in with us. Liz is our new best friend because what she just did was the funniest thing known to man. You really rhyme with that bit, too. You two are wasting your time not doing improv, but I really believe that you need to.
Liz does sketch comedy.
I do you really? Yeah. It's so fun because I like the writing. I like that I can take my time and think about my jokes rather than just get up there and bam, perform, make
just
people laugh.
Do it, yeah.
Yeah. But I do, I love improv. I respect it a lot. I think it takes a lot of wit and skill.
I can't believe that they're actually driving. So, right away, like, look, everyone, we're in a car. And then I'll just yell out, well, then you're jerking that car back and forth because that's no way to drive.
Terrible form.
Over here, Fez. We'll be right back with her before. It's the Ron and Fez show.
Ron and Fez on Raw Dog. Comedy Hits. Channel 99. B Network Radio gets you ready for opening day with a comprehensive tour of spring training. After a crazy offseason,
John Lester's a Cub, Matt Kemp a Padre, Matt Scherzer joins the Nationals.
Our analysts will take you inside every clubhouse, cover all the key storylines, and see how your team stacks up. Jim Bowden and Casey Stern visit the Rangers in surprise today at 5 p.m. Eastern on MLB Network Radio, Sirius 209, XM 89, and the Sirius XM app.
I love spring training!
Listen up, guys. A lot of guys think all underwear and undershirts are the same. I can tell you they're not. Tom Patterson here, founder and CEO of Tommy John, the revolutionary men's underwear brand that's taken the undergarment industry to the next level. The truth is, underwear has evolved since 1992. At least ours has. We use a patented, lightweight, breathable fabric that moves in 16 different directions and never rides up your legs. With a no-roll waistband and no wedgie guarantee, your body has never experienced comfort like this. Tommy John makes you look and feel amazing while keeping you cool and comfortable down under. Plus, Tommy John makes the only undershirt that stays tucked in. It keeps you 2 to 3 times cooler, dries 4 to 5 times faster, and never shrinks like the multi-packs you buy. It also eliminates excess bunching under your dress shirts, doesn't yellow as quickly, and uses a super thin fabric to keep you from overheating. I'm telling you, Tommy John will change your life.
Go to TommyJohn.com now and enter promo code LAUGH to get 15% off your first order. That's TommyJohn.com, promo code LAUGH for 15% off. TommyJohn.com.
SiriusXM presents an Entertainment Weekly radio special with the cast of the new sci-fi blockbuster, Chappie.
I don't want to die, I want to live.
With Hugh Jackman.
The artificial intelligence is way too unpredictable.
Sigourney Weaver.
Burn it to ash.
And director Neil Blomkamp.
When you step in evolution,
I am Chappie.
Join EW's Jess Cagle with the cast of Chappie today, 1 p.m. East, 10 a.m. West on Entertainment Weekly Radio, SiriusXM 105, or listen on the SiriusXM app.
This week on Comedy Dynamics Monday, it's the new release from Coco Brown, One Funny Mama.
I'm going for the gusto. Get me a white man. Yes. I want to know what it's like to walk into a bank or a car dealership and hear those two wonderful words. You're approved.
One Funny Mama from Coco Brown, Monday, 7 p.m. East on Raw Dog Comedy Hits 99.
After 30 years, boxing is back on NBC Primetime. Tomorrow night, live at 8:30 Eastern, 5:30 Pacific, the world's best fighters return to NBC as Keith Thurman does battle with Robert Guerrero and Adrian Broner goes to war with John Molina Jr. This is the start of a whole new era in boxing. Hosted by Al Michaels, with commentary by Marv Albert, Sugar Ray Leonard, and Layla Ali. Tomorrow night, live on NBC at 8:30 Eastern, 5:30 Pacific, premier boxing champions, where the next legends collide.
The following was recorded at a Burger King drive-thru at breakfast.
Morning, welcome to Burger King.
Can I have a bacon, egg, and cheese croissant?
I'm sorry, what's that word you're saying?
Croissant?
What, mama?
Croissant? There's a big poster here.
Oh, you mean croissant? The light, flaky, buttery sandwiches that are 2 for $4.
Yep.
Sure, why didn't you say so in the first place?
Get 2 croissant breakfast sandwiches for just $4, only at Burger King. Limited time only. Price and participation vary.
The Players Tribune is on Mad Dog Sports Radio, founded by Derek Jeter, hosted by Ben Lyons. The Players Tribune gives you unfiltered takes from the biggest names in sports.
From the Pittsburgh Pirates, Andrew McCutchen joins us.
Major League pitcher, Matt Harvey.
The Boss Man himself, Derek Jeter.
Seahawks quarterback, Russell Wilson.
I've had 3 years in the NFL so far, and I got a lot more to accomplish, and so I keep striving for greatness.
Bringing the voice of the game to your radio. The Players Tribune, Wednesdays at 7 p.m. Eastern on Mad Dog Sports Radio, Sirius XM 85.
I've never been on a business trip before. What do you guys do on them anyway?
Now, get ready for Unfinished Business, the most outrageous comedy of the year.
Snoop Lion, probably time to pass that.
Dr. Corcoran!
How far would you go?
I'm like pancake.
Like breakfast.
It's Greek.
It's delicious.
Yum.
To close the deal.
All the sex line.
This is the best trip ever.
I lost my virginity twice.
I'm losing confidence in the team.
Unfinished Business. Rated R. Under 17, not admitted without parent. Now playing only in theaters.
Ron and Fez on Raw Dog.
Raw Dog.
Comedy.
Thank you.
show. Lots of cool stuff going on this weekend, including Night of Too Many Stars. That's Sunday night. Going up on the iBank today is the story of a young lady who has an autistic child and tells why it's so important to get behind this. She's one of the writers for the iBang, and it's a really moving piece. So if you get over and read that. Also up on the iBank today is the mitzvah kid who I still... This kid makes me believe in bullying because someone should have stopped him from acting this way instead of his parents acting like this is the most lovely thing that a child could do. It's up on the iBank. What's the name of the story?
You'll never unsee this mitzvah invite.
All right. Well, go ahead and play the song as this annoying young man enjoys himself. Brody. Kid, let's stop it here. You got to put the sound up on it, all right? Take it back to the beginning and put the sound up.
It might seem crazy what I'm about to say. The countdown's begun to my mitzvah day. Trying to study hard, but my head's up in space. Hands in the air, like I don't care, just wanna partay. Because I'm Jewish. Clap along if you feel like Old Testament is the truth. Because I'm Jewish. Clap along if you're 13, that means you're no longer a youth. Because I'm Jewish. Clap along if you just tried Manischewitz and it tastes like juice. Because I'm Jewish. Clap along if you're my maid, you wear a really expensive suit. Cause all of me would love all of you to come attend my mitzvah party. My mom will probably cry and get all snotty. You're gonna lift all of me in a horror high above you. Check out the service at the beginning. I'll be the guy on the Bema tweeting hashtag I'm winning. You'll understand every word I read, even if you are not a Jew. Whoa. I'm gonna make my brother wear a dress and put my sister in a cage, just like my doggies. Cause my parents all kind of stress. They'll all do what I say, cause this here's my party. And I'm allowed to be spoiled. Shouting orders like a king, and you cannot make a fuss. Even if you think it sucks, let me be your ruler. Call me King Brody, and baby I'll rule, I'll rule, I'll rule, I'll rule. That's my mitzvah fantasy. Let it go. Any mitzvah jokes here? I just always wanted to try that. Everybody get up. Bring your sleeping bag. Don't even hesitate. We're going all night. That's how we celebrate. Maybe we'll all go deaf. Maybe we'll all go blind. Maybe we're out of our minds. I'm seeing blurred lines. Dancing with my rabbi. Bread on standby.
Now we're looking at a naked 13-year-old boy.
Blurred lines, RSVP to my party.
Ugh.
It's all about me. Everybody get up.
Now, Molly, you are half a Jew.
Yes.
Do you think that this is cute, or someone needs to settle this young man down?
Did you relate? I think, I don't know what to think, because on the one hand, I think it's really creative, and on the other hand, I think it's crazy and really, like, Just so embarrassing.
Look, he didn't think of and do this himself.
Yeah, that's
he
true.
He had help.
And his
the
parents.
The help of an adult. Now, my mom would have taken off her shoe and beat me with the heel as a way of saying, stop it. You have to go out into the world. Don't let them hurt you. Someone's going to teach him that this doesn't go away. This is like a tattoo. I'd rather see it with a tattoo of a naked woman inside a martini glass. At 13, I'd rather have him with that.
Well, at least he's really comfortable being himself. I don't know.
All right, Sean knows about this. Hi, Sean. You're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, what's going on?
Hey.
Yeah, so my daughter was invited to the bat mitzvah. We got the invitation last week with the DVD in the mail, so it's pretty. It's quite a hit around here.
It's a real thing. Now, does your daughter think that this makes sense?
He is a hero at school.
This is the world that we live in now.
Everyone wants to know him. Everyone wants to take a picture with him because there's. Living here, there's bar mitzvahs every weekend. So my daughter goes to two or three bar mitzvahs, and she'll see him there. People want to take pictures with him. So
everybody, he's the YouTube sensation.
Yep.
This is the world that these kids live in, that you're a YouTube sensation.
And, you know, as Jews, we, we're known for having a sense of humor, so.
Yeah, but you always used to be known for having a funny sense of humor. I mean, seriously, we're not going to compare this kid to Woody Allen.
No.
We're not going to compare this kid to Alan King. I'm going to even take that further. I don't think he's as funny as Alan Dershowitz. That's how far down the line I'm going here. Hey, Bill, what's up?
A big-ass card over 2975.
What can we do for you, Bill?
Listen, I can't imagine this is a 13-year-old kid. This sounds like Shelby. It's freaking Shelby. It's got to be.
It's Shelby. Why don't we do a parody video with you, Shelby? You do all the exact things. Here's Ryan. Ryan, go ahead.
Ryan, how are you?
Cool in the gang, my friend. Cool in the motherfucking gang.
So what this video is missing, and I saw it this morning, and my daughter said, oh, don't watch it. He's naked. So spoiler alert. It's missing production values, Ron.
I don't know. Okay.
And there's another video. Just check it out. It's called I'm Zach. Google it. YouTube it. A kid from Washington. His father works in a production studio. That's how you do a bar mitzvah video.
Why don't these kids just make it about the actual traditional thing instead of calling it a mitzvah and seeing how much money they can spend? Hey, Vinny, go ahead. What do you got?
Hey, this is what happens when you live in a world where there's no bullying allowed in school. If this was back in the old days, this kid would have had a beating thrown at him.
That would have been somewhat helpful if some older kids could have pointed out that this is not the way you want to act.
And Ronnie, that builds character. These kids, I don't know what's going to happen in the future with these kids. They can do whatever they want. Nobody straightens them out.
I will tell you the difference here. I always do the New York lean to people, right?
Right.
If I see a friend of mine, I lean my shoulder into him, and I push him against the wall, and they can't see who's doing it. So I did it to my young, I'm not going to say effeminate intern, but a sensitive intern named MK. And his feet were going crazy, and he was yelling, I'm sorry. And he's in New York. Now, when I was younger in New York, he would go, put your crazy face on, we're going into New York. And you would be ready to fucking act like a maniac to not get hurt. But this means that you're walking around New York now without street sense. You don't know how to fight, run, get away, whatever it takes. They don't have as many options because they think they should live in a safe world.
Do you think that that's a result of people not bullying other people in schools?
Yeah, I think... You know, I think there used to be a lot when you would go into the city and your dad would say, take off your watch, put your rings in your pockets, necklaces inside with the necklace. I think people are like, okay, I got it. I'm supposed to not stick out here like somebody with any money or anything shiny.
I think the reason why people don't like this is not... It's just because they find this person annoying.
It's glee. It's the gleification of this country. When we start to act like glee was good, we lost any hipness, any coolness that we had.
Maybe he's going to grow up and become like a really creative musician or something. Do you ever think of like how many people didn't end up pursuing an artsier, like more off the beaten path passion because they were bullied?
No, just the opposite. I'd say people who do that were bullied. We're going to have Kate Pierson. I guarantee you that the B-52s were picked on during their time. I guarantee you David Bowie was picked on before he got big. Marilyn Manson has a song called You're Gonna Get My Medal about beating the other kids with a metal lunchbox because they fucked with him. When you feel no sense of failure and danger, you do mediocre work. When you feel you need to break through, it's a do or die situation. This kid, at the most, is going to end up like a PA on The Voice. That's how far he'll go.
I don't think he's been bullied because the other kids know he's gay, and they've been told not to bully.
About this kid.
I think for his age.
All right, I'm going to just bring that up to you, Fez. Do you think this kid is gay?
No, I didn't think he was gay.
Yeah, I don't think so at all.
I didn't pick up on that.
I think for his age, like to do the feminine moves and that, I don't think you do that at that age.
Well, I thought he was doing like a Milton Berle silliness. I thought he was going for...
It was, I'm going to put on a dress and a wig and look really silly in this thing.
Yeah, like cheap laughs, like what the football team does at a pep rally. You know, the guys are like, look at this. I got balloons instead of breasts, right? So you want to see real bullying? It's misogyny. Get together and think about that sometimes, girl.
We will.
Until you stand up, right? Until you kill your first hetero, I don't want to hear anything.
Okay.
What?
It's between me and the yard, okay?
The yard. How have I not called you Ard before?
I don't know. Ard, bring
Chris,
it.
Chris, you're on the Run and Fez show.
Hey, Chris?
Yeah, it's you, Chris.
Hey, man, I'm sorry. When I was in the military years ago, these kids are already starting to filter into the military.
Oh, Jesus.
And it's making it dangerous. They've never been in a fight. They're going to run tail on somebody.
I'm sure a lot of kids have never been in fights.
Well, I mean, what are we going to do when they got to go fight overseas for us and they want to call time out?
What's going to happen is ISIS will throw them off of buildings like they do now. They'll just wait till they show up and chuck them off a building.
I had a kid in boot camp tell me he was going to tell on him. I was trying to start a fight with this kid, and he said, look, I'm going to go tell the drill instructor to come out here and tell him you're picking on me. And I was like, man, we're in the Marine Corps boot camp, dude. What are you doing? You got to have some respect for yourself.
You don't realize you are the problem in that? You're the one starting fights in the platoon?
But it's a platoon. No, it's about toughening up. That's the thing.
It wasn't his job to toughen the other guy up.
Didn't you ever watch any movies? You're supposed to put your soap in a pillowcase and beat pile until finally he kills the drill instructor and then himself. It's all just a dream, fat boy. It's all just a dream. Hey, you're on the Ron and Fez show.
Hey, guys. If you look in the background on this video, this is that family that does all those stupid Thanksgiving and Christmas YouTube videos. The guy who was the weatherman and decided to make YouTube videos instead.
Wait, are you telling me that guy put this together for him?
I don't know. I'm guessing so.
The same production company? So to go back to what Molly's saying, this isn't even the kid being creative. This is somebody else putting him in this situation.
That's weird.
Because they know it'll go viral.
It's like some Dance Moms.
Yes. And we are a society now where Dance Moms, it's okay. I mean, first of all, we live in a society where I can't operate on a child. And I know I would do good at it. I wouldn't try to operate on an adult. That's too complicated. But I think I could probably fix a child's heart.
And you can't operate on a child because people aren't being bullied.
Well, they're saying I don't have the schooling that it takes to do it, even though I know I could get in there and do it perfectly.
Street smarts.
Because, yeah, street smarts. Like, I'll figure it out. Well, first of all, as soon as I split that little chest open, I see the heart. I know the first thing I'll say.
What?
Aw.
Aw.
Aw. Look at that little
heart.
He's
so cute.
There's bees. Petey. I'm going to call you Petey because your heart's beating.
As he bleeds slowly to death.
Oh, that's so funny. You know? Who's bleeding? Who's bleeding out? Where's that bleeding baby? Why did you freeze on this?
Because he takes... it's a bar mitzvah video. He's taking Judaism seriously to the point where he's having a bar mitzvah, yet he wears the hat and the payas in the video for laughs.
Like he's making fun of Jews, yes. He's making fun of the entire thing. The fact that you even called it a mitzvah. Ugh. Anyway, that's up on the iBang. The other stuff that's up there today was the little toddler who is cracking an egg. That kid is adorable. The praying mantis and the weird things that they do.
I love that. Ugh. It was cool.
Ugh.
You just don't think about that. How many, like, that's taken thousands and thousands of years, like, for that to be the thing that was selected that's, like, the, you know, that's, like, the advantageous body movement, and now that's what they do. You know?
It's amazing.
It's unbelievable.
One thing nature has is time. Like, evolution will evolve over millions of years. There's no hurry. And I saw this the other day. 2.5 billion years ago, Mars had oceans. A giant ocean on Mars. There was a time, if we had a time machine, we could go to Mars and go swimming. Aww. It was probably really nice.
Get some sun on Mars.
Wouldn't it be ironic if it was the first time someone drowned it on Mars?
It was the time that we went back in the time machine?
Yeah. And then you accidentally drowned it. If you got in a time machine, would you jump into it?
I don't know. Yes, I would. Yes, I would.
Forward or backwards?
I would go forward, because I would be discriminated against in the past.
It's very funny. My daughter said the same thing to me. She goes, "No, I would never go back further than like 40 years.
Yeah.
I'd go crazy.
Yeah,
I'd go crazy if someone told me what to wear. Yeah, you would only have to go forward. People forget that women, and like some people are like, I'm not a feminist at all. I kind of find them creepy. I'm like, you ever read a book? You ever find out what the world was like
just by accident
before some of those people? Do you ever see what happened down in the village of those young girls that they used to tie to sewing machines and make them work 18 hours a day? What happened when the building caught on fire? Oh, that's right. We never thought of how to get them out. Those little women slaves.
But this, I think, brings back the point of the bullying and the bar mitzvah boy thing, because I think we're moving in, like, a particular direction where people are just better to each other. And that, like, that I know that, you know, that people are getting softer and that, you know, like, some people haven't been in a fight and, like, the good old days of street smarts and everything. But, like, if you look at the past, bullying was, like, to an extreme with, like, you know, lynching and stuff like that. And now we're moving in a different direction, like a more pacifist
direction. How do you think we did it,
though?
Because it happened over my lifetime. Because I'm old enough to remember seeing adults fight when I was a kid. Like, seeing adults go like this. Really? Fuck you. Let's go. We would just, like, it would be like a family gathering. We'd all be like, they're fighting outside. Let's go. You know? And, like, now if that happened... Everybody, you know, and my mom be like, let them fight. Let them get it over with. They'll be back. You know, and they would. It would happen. But what happened where people stopped acting that way?
I think you just realize that it's not productive. Yeah, that it's not productive. And that we're like human beings. We're not animals, you know? I mean, we are, but we're not. We're like...
But a lot of things change at the same time. The DUIs went incredibly down, where that used to be not even a thing to get arrested for. I mean, you would have had to run someone over. You know, you would have to actually hit a baby coach before they would say, okay, you've had too much to drink. We're taking you in. In the 80s, that switched over, but everything started to get more and more passive down to the point now where we are. And yet I still think people say horrible things.
Yeah.
See, I think people say more horrible things now because they can't get punched in the fucking face over it.
Hmm. Well, there's online bullying now, too, where you can be anonymous and bully people. I think that's potentially, I mean, that wasn't ever a thing. Bullying was more to your face, and now you can bully whoever you want
make it an anonymous account.
Yeah. You used to have to back up what you said.
Yeah.
Where people would say, don't write a check with your mouth that your ass can't cash. Because you'd have to go, oh, he heard me. Fuck. I have to fight now. Ouch.
You that really hurts. Think people talked less smack before than they do now?
I think they were ready to back it up. I think you would not. Yes, I think they would. I mean, if you go around and read the things that people write online, they're unbelievable.
Yeah.
And I don't think any of them expect anyone to show up and say, really, do you want to back that up?
See, I don't think the bullying disappeared. It just changed location.
Hmm.
It just went online and not so much in the physical world.
If it's not a physical world thing, then it's not real. That's what I would say to people. Like, to be physically bullied is pretty frightening. To be bullied online, you delete
move on. Like, that stuff like that has lasting consequences for people. There are people who are like, I mean, it's happened a million times that someone is, like, disturbed. Like, that, you know, they have, like, depression or bipolar or something, and then people target them online, and then they end up killing themselves. That happens all the time. Or if someone comes out, and then like, people from their school write mean things to them, and then they end up killing themselves. Like,
Don't kill yourself.
No, I'm not gonna, but...
But, I mean, anyone. Just, who cares what someone says to you?
I think it's easier said than done until you've been online bullied.
But you think of it
I work in radio. Of course I've been online bullied.
But you think of it like as if you live in the internet. But if you think of it as like real life, somebody saying the worst thing to you, they're just doing this. They're not like actually screaming into their computer. They're doing the same thing you're doing while
you're reading. So you're saying typing is not as dangerous as words.
Yeah, I mean, if you think, like, you picture them in your mind as being, like, some scary, if you're, like, really the bullying affects you, and them, like, screaming those same words at you, but they're really just...
But a lot of bullying comes from girls where you're never physically worried about them, but you're socially worried. Hey, we're doing Youth Talk with Ron Bennington. Give us a call. If you're worried about bullying or girls cutting themselves or anorexics or what else is wrong with you fuckers? I'm cutting myself and not eating enough.
But people that do the trolling online and like even against comedians, like saying how bad their act is and then they retweet them and then they respond, they don't write in the same way they talk in real life. They talk in some weird, like, old-timey, like, in all my years, I've never seen a more profoundly unfunny, like, you would never say that
for a second. Do you think he's making any sense, Fez, or is it just me? I've never seen ye old English online. I've read stuff. Here's what I'm saying. A person will do that to a famous comedian, right?
Right.
To get his attention. Because that gets attention. If someone writes to you and says, you're great, you're just like, thanks. But if someone writes to you and says, you suck, and your show, they do it to Fez all the time, and your show sucks, you're more likely to come back and they're going to know that they changed your state.
Well, so that does affect you, though. It's not completely removed from your own,
but
like...
it's up to Fez whether he decides to have it affect him or not.
Yeah, I think over time, like, I think...
You can be worn down?
No, that you can be worn down. Like, in the beginning, I think, like, for me, like, that people would say stuff about me online, and then that would be really hurtful, and now it's like, you said this once to me, that it's like a homeless person on the street yelling stuff at you. You're just
homeless.
Like, whatever. You know, that person's crazy.
I like that image. Right.
Yeah.
But it is true. There's no reason to give them any image more. And I remember once, years ago, of fighting back with somebody and then finding out that they were a child. You know what I mean? Like, I was fighting with a 14-year-old. And I'd be like, what the fuck do you know about radio? People could first meet you. And they were like in eighth grade. But the first time somebody said anything to me in an AOL chat room, which would have to be in the 90s, I was typing, I will get on a fucking plane and fly there and fuck you up. And I had to learn, wait, it's not real. No one, let's suppose now, if someone said something to me in an AOL chat room in 1995 and I killed myself, you guys would think that that's a joke. You're like, what was wrong with him? Why would he care about an AOL chat room?
Yeah, I guess for some people it's really inescapable, though.
It's up to you. Now that you're making these separate realities, you've got to decide which one matters to you. and Twitter cannot possibly matter.
I guess for some people, it's not two separate realities. Like, I think, and I agree with you, I think this is a problem, that our virtual lives are so intertwined with our real lives that it's hard for people to distinguish the fact that a person, you know, trolling you behind a screen is completely different than, like, one of your friends deserting you.
But can I tell you something? We're making up virtual lives. They're not real. That's like saying I had a bad dream last night, so I killed myself. And we say it's not real. This is your friend. Okay? If she steals your boyfriend, you know what I mean?
Uh-oh.
You can feel betrayed. But if she didn't sign off with the right icon or whatever the hell you need, she didn't Snapchat you back.
You didn't use the palm tree? God.
She's really funny.
She is the
best. She's funny, man.
She's really
funny. But see what I'm saying? It's up to you. You're making up. You're giving this a reality purpose.
Yeah.
It's not real.
But that's a lesson people have to learn.
Right. And I also think it builds from someplace else. It's not just like one day you decide to ignore your online haters. Like it's your whole life you're making an effort to not make your virtual life real.
Here's the thing I go through with Fez. He'll say, the callers hate me, right? Meaning he gives the same responsibility to, if one caller says something to him, he thinks of it as all the callers. As if they move like a school of fish. Now, as many times as I've described to him, no, you have to look at this as individuals and plenty of people like you. He chooses to see it as a school of fish. Then we'll have some days that if I'll just hit the phones, he's wincing because he thinks it's all the same thing. That's a reality that he has supplied that. And even me giving my reality, it doesn't change anything for him. He chooses to believe that. It's not that he's incapable of saying that as individuals.
I don't see that as an individual choice, though. I think that's a bunch of things compounded that like you view, that you view your virtual life as like having more value in other ways, and that's an effect of that. Do you know what I'm saying?
I don't understand that, but I know that there's days. When I will forward an email that I got to Ron and be very upset about it. And there's other times, like I got another one this week where it's just like, you know, delete.
Wait, what did you get?
Oh, another kill yourself email.
I take it from you sitting here that you didn't do it.
I did not follow the instructions.
Mm. So you feel like that's a growth for you?
Oh, no. It would be growth if I could sustain that. I'm sure there'll be more where I'm like, you know, sending this to you and having a meltdown over it. No, and I also, and I know I try to catch it and not let it affect me so much, but it always does. But I know I have caught myself too, like if I get one bad email, I'll explain it to Ron as people keep emailing me, where it's more than one. That generalization will happen.
Here's Garrison in Wisconsin.
Hey, Ronnie. Hey,
yeah.
The thing that everybody really needs to realize is it is two separate areas. I mean, you go to school with people and they actually bully you physically face-to-face. That's one thing. If you're online, if most of these people that you go to school with, you will never have contact again in the rest of your life.
But you're saying that because you're from my generation. And I've moved away from people and never seen them again because I don't go on Facebook. But if I went on Facebook, I'd talk to everybody that I was in elementary school with. It's like my kid was bumming around England for the past 2 weeks, and we would be texting. And I'm going, this is fucking wild that you text someone like he was in Brooklyn, but he's in England, you know? It just seems so crazy to me that you're never really separated, you know? I brought this up before on the show. I would be in high school, and I'd say to my mom, I'm going down the beach. And she's like, when are you coming back? I go, Sunday, but if I can't get a ride, probably Monday or Tuesday. So I'll be gone 4 to 7 days, 8 tops. And off I'd go. And she did not worry because she would think, well, he'll be back. And, you know, I'm sure if 10 days rolled around, she would probably say, look, I'm getting nervous about this. But people didn't sit around and worry like they do now.
But But people, like, disappeared and murders were unsolved at, like, a much higher rate back when that was the case.
Do you know that for a fact?
Yeah, the murders being unsolving, I do know for a fact.
Well, I'm sure it was, but whether it's a solved murder or unsolved murder, is it any better for you? Like, I'm sure that we have better stuff today. But I also know this, people worry more now, even though they're connected more. Where someone will go, I haven't heard from somebody in 3 hours, and they're freaked. And you're like, 3 hours?
They can't. Because they know that they could get in touch.
Yeah. But yeah, no one's left alone. I know one girl that was murdered. Do you know any people that were murdered?
No.
I'll say this. I know one innocent person who was murdered. I know a couple people who...
who had a company.
Well, they went in the wrong fucking place is what they did. But I'm not sure that it's helped us. I don't think we're smarter now, and I don't think we're safer, and I don't think we're more comfortable.
I don't think we're smarter now. I just think that people have a broader, like, worldview now than they did. You would never think of going, like, to China from the United States back then, and, like, now the fact that you have access to, like, you know, you could see a Google Maps, like, literally, like, a replica, you know, moment by moment video of that. Street, like, just makes you consider the fact that people actually exist in that part of the world.
But doesn't that also take the mystery out of it? You know what I mean? Like, isn't there something? The fact is, no one's going to be going down the river. You know what I mean? You're not going to be going down the river in that steamer and going, you know, turning the corner and not knowing. You're going to get to China and it's going to look like New Jersey.
Yeah, I mean, aside from the, like, the sort of westernization of China, I mean, like, that you're not, it's not possible to be ignorant of that anymore. Like, that you have to have a more real concept beyond, like, the stereotype of people in China because you
like,
have...
Like, this is the concept that I have right now. Do I have the right concept?
No.
What about when I say this? Because I know how they talk. A-chang chong. Look, a friend of mine over there, and he ate panda in China. And they came up and they're like, this is an endangered species. And he goes like this. Oh, I'm not from around here.
It's not my fault.
But he also said it was delicious.
What was it like? More like chicken or more like...
Yeah, it was like a wing, but a really big one.
A wing.
A wing.
The wings of the pandas.
You know, there is a thing up there. There's a chicken killer in South Carolina right now who has killed 300,000 chickens in the last couple weeks. And he's breaking into these chicken houses, giant coops, and he's either turning up the thermostat to either be really hot or really cold. And he's killed hundreds of thousands of chickens.
Why? What's his motivation?
I'm going to guess that he's in pork sales. I think that's probably...
That's it.
Or maybe a chicken fucked with him once or something. I don't know. But or maybe he's just a, you know, psychopath.
Probably the last one.
All right, there's a skills check, literacy, math skills, technological, problem solving, and the American millennials. That's where you guys are?
Yeah, we're millennials.
Finished dead last worldwide in adult skills.
In adult skills?
Yeah.
What are those? Like, what are the...
Being able to be literacy, math... well, this is why you failed, I guess. You don't even know that part.
Oh, wait, I find that hard to believe that literacy rates are lower for millennials than for previous generations.
We're always on
the
internet.
Well, you're up against,
reading.
I guess, the other millennials.
Oh, American millennials.
American millennials.
Okay, yeah, we suck. Yeah. So, yeah.
Now I believe it. I was like, I don't think we're more literate or less literate than our parents.
I'm sure you've read less books, though. I mean, because there are not as many books as I think you get a lot more information, but the retaining.
Yeah.
You couldn't doing this job, I have to read everything but retain almost nothing. I call it fuck fish. When I'm done with something, right? If I have an interview, I pay attention to it. I obsess on it. But then when it's over, I'm like, I can't know anything about that. And people go, I want to talk to you. And I'm like, I don't. I'm moving on. I got to clear a little brain space. But I call it fuck fish from that Charlie Hoffman movie where the guy said that he collected fish and all, you know, he bought fish. He goes, then one day I just looked around. I said, fuck fish. I never step in another big toe in this ocean again. And I haven't. And then he moved on to flowers. But I think everyone has to be that way now.
Yeah.
You know, you just can't sit around and ponder a novel like they used to. They would ponder novels or philosophy for years at a time. Joseph Campbell just made a point of just reading book after book after book and thinking about it. And then when he was like in his 40s, said, you know what? I'm going to start writing myself.
I was reading something about how like boredom is a really important avenue for creativity, and like that, because people, you know, in between floors in the elevator, you take out your phone, or like while you're waiting for the doctor's office, you take out your phone, and that space is like really important for creative thinking, and then people don't have that anymore, and it's like part of the reason why a lot of young people specifically feel like so bogged down. Like, I don't know about you, but sometimes after staring at a screen, I just feel like my head's gonna explode. Like,
Do you ever have time for daydreaming? Do you ever think
in the car?
Yeah.
Like in transit, but not like if I'm sitting in my room, I'm listening to music,
or right before bed, or even in the shower.
Yeah.
Because you always hear about people getting great ideas in the shower.
Right.
So I think that has to do with it.
But you even peruse, and I do too, like on our phones, like, you know, right before we go to bed, like reading the news and stuff like that.
Yeah, true. Yeah, but then you still put it down. You don't fall asleep immediately.
I do.
I keep a little notebook right by my bed because I know that I'm always going to think of something that I either forgot that I still have to do. A sketch idea, something.
Hmm. I keep a notebook of just mean things I want to say to Fez later. It's part of my online bullying.
What can I say tomorrow?
Kill yourself, because you deserve to die. Kill yourself. Why would that even bother you even once?
I don't. It's just a really mean thing to say, where someone thinks you shouldn't even be on the planet Earth.
They don't
Earth.
Even know you. They know like a single aspect of one day of your personality, you know?
It's true. They have no place to make that decision. They don't have enough information for that. Tim, Tulsa.
Hey, Fezzy Million Bucks. Ronnie, this might just be because I've never had any experience with it. I've never done it to anybody. But being bullied via social media to the point where you kill yourself, isn't that kind of just nature's way of weeding out the herd, you know?
Yeah, well, the human experience is not one of just keeping the most powerful. At no point have we said, you know what we need to do is kill like sickly children.
Yeah.
Or though, you know, I mean, the human experience seems more to embrace and have empathy. I guess if we were water buffalo, you might be onto something, but we're not. I mean, you guys are laughing at that, but that really isn't the whole point of being a human being. Let's have the most powerful people we possibly can.
Yeah, like leaving the weakest behind. Is that, like, that is just so, what is that called? Eubonics? Is that the right word?
Ebonics. That's like, leave that dead ass behind. Oh, wait. I think it was talking
about that's not the word. Eugenics? I don't know. Yeah. I'll look it up.
Oh, eugenics is that thing that Anthony got in trouble for quoting.
Yeah, when you think that like people of different races are superior and therefore like, you know, whatever. But yeah, that's what that reminds me of.
Well, normally, see, here's the thing. It also, all those things are skewed by the type of childhood you had in terms of money and opportunity and stuff. It is somewhat harder to catch up in education. But it's not, also education is not the sole way of measuring a person's worth. Like, what would you say is the worth of a person? If you were having a child, what would you be looking for before you set that child out in the world?
I would want them to be able to, like, look outside of their own, like, mind frame. I would want them to be able to, not necessarily, like, to be a pushover or anything like that, but just to be able to, like, empathize. So that you're not just acting strictly on drive. Like, you need food now, and like you need this because you want it, but that you're able to see like how that affects other people.
What do you think, Liz?
Yeah, and respect. Be respectful of other people and their opinions. So differences in opinions too, that to know that not everyone's going to think like you do, and that doesn't make them better or worse than you.
It's almost like what you really want to have is a good person.
Just a good person.
Like to give society back a good person, a thinking, feeling help. I think it's so rare that someone goes, looks at a baby and goes, I want this baby to be so rich.
Really powerful.
I want this baby to work really hard and just drive everyone else. I think that happens with some parents as life goes along. But I think you want that person to enjoy life and to spread joy in life,
yeah,
you know, as much as they can. And Fez, you've done that in spades. I mean, you enjoy life, you embrace it, you suck the nectar out of it, and then what do? You're always helpful and giving to other people. What was it that you said to Shelby earlier this week?
Oh, that I wish he was dead?
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Beautiful. You actually said, he screamed at him, I wish that tumor of yours turned out to be cancerous. Now, this is the same guy who's like, I feel bad because people send me things. By the way, there's no
such... Yeah, but Shelby should.
Let's go over to Brian. Brian in Colorado. Go ahead, Brian.
You guys are talking about the polarizing nature of connectivity and social networking and the internet and that kind of thing and how dichotomous it could be for different generations. I just wanted to play devil's advocate for a second. You guys are talking about boredom, that opportunity to let those creative juices flow and how you kind of don't have that anymore because you have an iPad or
Yes, we know what you said. What is it you'd like to add to this conversation?
I just wanted to play devil's advocate and say, well,
please fucking say
all that boredom for creative thought, couldn't you use that connectivity to get inspiration? You find something inspiring online?
Inspiration is different than just copying. And I think that we have a lot of that today, that you see the way other people do things and you mirror it or lift it. There's also a lot of hive think. But is there any amount of hive thinking that could compare with, let's say, Michelangelo or Da Vinci? You know, there's something so amazing about the single genius. And maybe we'll never have that. Again, maybe that kind of thinking is going to be gone because the machines themselves are so much more complex.
Also, I think we overestimate or underestimate the importance of just having your own like mental space, that you're constantly, there are constant opportunities for inspiration, like everywhere you go. And so to have like a moment to sort of just let your own brain compress and like sort of process everything, I think that that's helpful. That you just need to be doing nothing sometimes.
The amount of daydreaming that I do is astronomical. It's almost frightening. I think one of the reasons why I can, you know, that I've had some success with interviewing people is generally I think about their lives a lot or their jobs and what it is to do it. And then if I think of things I don't know the answer to, I go, oh, yeah, I wonder how that works. I end up talking to them about that. And they're like, oh, yeah, no one's ever asked me that before because a lot of people will ask the same questions over and over and over, going back to what that guy said, that if you go through this by reading a lot of what other people say, you might think that's the way to do an interview. You know, just like if you were a band and you're like, I've gone out and looked at every other band out there, now I sound just like them. You're not going to have a talking heads where everybody goes, what the fuck? What is that dude doing? That doesn't even sound like singing down there anymore.
And I think he was, what he said about the internet was sort of the internet on paper. But once you act like how, oh, we can all share information. But once you actually get on, is there really that much amazing?
Well, let's say this. Let's suppose that I was interested in model airplanes and I lived in Western Canada. And I'd be able to get on the internet and talk to other people who are interested in model airplanes, and you're able to go and do that. That doesn't take up with the amount of time that you've wasted on porn.
Yeah.
And, you know, reading about your favorite sports team and writing about how the coach is a jerk off. I mean, there's a lot of wasted time on there. But it is amazing that you can live anywhere in the world now and say to yourself, what was the 1920s jazz scene in Paris like? And boom, being able to find out. Now, is that the same experience of going to Paris and being part of that culture? No, I don't think so. Any more than being able to do your Google Maps and see what the blocks look like before you get there.
Yeah, I don't think that that's a replacement for the actual experience.
But I'm wondering if it even takes away from the experience of being shocked, of having your system shocked because you know what you're looking for, you know?
Yeah. I don't know. I just think that you're shocked in different ways.
I'll give you an example, just to tell the world. I had this friend, and he went to Africa with his parents, right? And they were killed. They were murdered in Africa. And some monkeys came in and grabbed him, and they took him up in the trees, and they raised him as one of their own. And I remember saying to him years later, I go, Tarzan, when you're when you're swinging around, do you feel like a monkey, or do you feel like a man? And he shit in his hand and threw it at me. And I'm like, okay, I get it. Monkey. Monkey again. Zachary. How are you?
Hey, I'm not doing too bad, you guys. And don't take this opinion any wrong way, because I hopped right in the middle of the conversation.
Go ahead and give it to us, buddy.
I think the guy wasn't too far off about thinning out the herd, but what you're looking for in terms of word is passive eugenics. That's not exactly where I'm at, though. There is a gene somewhere that it allows the thought process of being able to kill yourself, and there are people who have the thought process of, I can't do it. It is natural selection that if a person does choose to do it, that inevitably that gene may be weeded out. I don't know what's going on with your whole conversation, but that's...
Well, I appreciate you throwing that in, but I will say this. As an adult, I haven't talked to too many people who haven't contemplated suicide at least once in their life. And most of the people, you know, didn't do it or half-assed attempted to do it. But I don't think it's that outside of the human condition that we go, sometimes I feel like quitting. You know what I mean?
I think about that, especially when you think about the expansion of like the human lifespan, that people used to live for 20 years and you could ride that out pretty well. But when you get into like 60 years, that's not, I mean, now it's the norm, but it wasn't. And I feel like sometimes suicide is a byproduct of that people are just like, when is this going to end? Like, I can't do 30 more years of this.
It hurts, particularly at that age. When you look at elderly people and their knees hurt at, you know, 70, and then you're like, you're probably going to live to be 100. You're like, 100 years of my knees hurting and my heels now? And I don't see so good? I don't know, that might be a little too much for me. Dom. Go ahead, Dom.
Hi, kids. How are you? Yeah. Hey, when I was 6 years old, I got in a fight, and I got my ass handed to me. And I run home underneath mom's skirt, and my dad come right in the house, took me by the hand, and took me out to the barn and said, you need to quit being a victim. If you're going to be a victim, you're going to be a victim for your life. And I've held with that, and it got me through Iraq, Afghanistan, and all that. I will never, ever be anyone's victim. And that goes to the computer, that goes to the iPhone, that goes to everything. I will not be anyone's victim. And I hold that to my heart. It makes no sense to give people that much power over your life. It never made sense to me why people do that. Give away your power to someone else and let them run over you. I don't understand it. I don't understand people.
Well, let's let Fez do that. What is the power of being the victim?
I don't feel like it's any power.
What is the power in quitting?
I don't know.
Of saying, I tap out. I don't want to keep going. And I don't mean on life. I mean on a project.
I guess it's... I'm not sure. I guess it's just frustration or feeling like you don't have the skills to do it.
But he was saying never give up. No matter what. I mean, your skills don't improve by quitting, right?
No. No, I don't know the answer to that.
I always think that there has to be something to be gained by anything that you do. You have to think that you're doing it for a positive reason. I don't think anyone does something that goes, like, I'm going to do something negative for myself right now. I think this is the only thing I can do. I think some people go like this, someone scuffed my shoes, I better murder them, or else people are going to be walking all over me all the time. That's the kind of thinking that we try to change here. But I don't think they set out to do something that they don't think is going to work for them. And that guy's saying, I will never be a victim. I will no matter what happens to him, he could be raped in the street, and he's not going to feel like a victim. Because to him, that's the worst thing that you could be, is a victim. And other people just feel like, help me. I need help. I don't know what I'm doing. I need somebody to come over here and pick me up and put a tip in my mouth. I want to stay a baby for the rest of my life.
I don't know.
Oh, go ahead, Liz.
I think that can take a certain strength sometimes, though, to know when that you actually need help and to ask for that help. I think that can show strength.
When do you ask for help?
I'm a student in school.
Yeah.
I need help a lot. I know that I'm not that smart compared to my professors. No, compared to like my professors. Okay. I know that even my parents, so I ask for help from my parents on experience. I'm young. I'm not that experienced. So that's when I ask for help. So I think that it's okay to ask for help.
But maybe there's a different kind of help between I want you to show me how to do this and I want you to do it for me. I think that's what we're talking about when you're victimizing.
Yeah, it's like agency.
Yeah.
That you're taking responsibility for your own thing.
And learning in the process, when you ask for help, that you actually learn something from it and don't just let it happen and don't retain anything.
What do you think, Fizz?
I think that makes sense. But I don't know where the strength comes from being a victim still. I don't.
It's got to be something. Somebody else is going to take care of you, I would think. I mean, it's easier to be taken. You have decided, if I do this, I will. It's almost like when you look at the animals who think, if I fake death, they'll walk past me. It's almost like when someone thinks, like I brought this up before, whenever my parents would hit me when I was a kid, I'd dive over a table and land on the floor. I mean, I would go out like a light. Just, I'd give them, oh, you want to hurt me? Boom, look, I just crashed up against the window and going down. And it would make everyone yell, like, you're acting! But I would be able to, it would all stop there.
Oh.
Because I've thrown myself around like a cheap stuntman. But even now, it's very weird. There's only one time when I constantly ask for help with anything, and that's strange.
When was that?
During masturbation. See, what that is considered as a humorous joke. That's a humorous joke. Help me. Shelby is, he won't ask anybody for help. And as a matter of fact, Fez was angry at you last night. Do you know why, Shelbs?
There's many reasons, but what is one?
One, for you contacting me and saying, I want to run the board for Bennington, right? And I said, sure. But what I didn't know is, like, you got out of the room with them. And tell me what you were mad about.
It was insane. We were all in the office. Shelby got up, left for 2 minutes, and an email came in from Shelby saying, I'm going to run the board for Bennington tomorrow morning. I stopped and I thought, you were just here 2 minutes ago. Why didn't you just bring this up in the room when we always talk about communicating in the office?
I had heard you. I asked you, and like I emailed him, and then I went to do something, and I got the ding on my phone that he had responded. So then I responded right then because I was still doing something. I understand, but like what you thought, but I was actually.
It looked like you left the room to write an email to everyone else in the room.
I was.
You were gone. It was that short of a time that you had walked out of the door.
And what did that mean to you, Fez?
That he doesn't want to communicate with us. He absolutely is against it, even though he says he wants to. And that no, there will just never be any communication.
I was surprised at how quickly Ron got back to me.
I have a phone. I just didn't bring one in today.
It was bizarre. It was.
Well, I know,
like,
I didn't want Fez to do anything because he felt ill last week. So you saying that, I'm like, oh, great idea. Just let them know. I didn't need to ponder it at all.
Yeah.
Believe me, if I had another working man, you never would have made it through, Shelby. Congratulations. It's like one of those things like in a war movie where so many other guys have gotten killed that you're the sergeant. Who we got coming up in here today, Fez?
Adam Carolla is coming up with his new movie, Wrote Hard.
And after that?
And then after that, Kate Pierson will be here.
Ladies, it was so nice having you in today.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
You look out for my friend Molly.
Of course,
always.
And
you take care of her, and you don't let her get bullied, and you make sure that she eats enough.
Yes.
And she stays away from drugs.
Keep my best friend voice going.
Yeah.
Encourage you. Call you every once in a while. Remind you that you're beautiful.
Yeah. I'm glad I'm here for you.
I'll always be here, Molly.
That's nice.
That's really
That's
nice.
The perfect voice. That's the best friend voice. You know what? It's probably a New Hampshire thing, isn't it?
Probably.
Yeah. People are nice there, aren't they?
They're very nice.
Oh.
Go New Hampshire.
People in New York would rather kill you as soon as look at you.
I'll kill you.
So, thank you, ladies. It was great to have you come in. You're back to school soon, though, right?
Yeah.
So, coming up a little later on, Kate Pierson from the B-52s, brand new album, and an interview with Adam Carolla, who has a new movie out now called Road Hard. Road Hard. Which is, it's actually very, very funny. And tons of funny people in it, including somebody we're playing tonight from Mass, Jay Moore. Jay Moore is part of this.
That's going to be on Ron Bennington Interviews tonight at 9 on Indie 102.
As a matter of fact, if I was gay, I think I'd want it to be with Jay Moore.
Jay Moore's a cutie.
Oh, and I have nothing to do with that. I just find him funny enough. I just find that once it was over, we could sit and have a damn good laugh about it all. All right. We'll go to a break here. And during that break, I think I'm going to go out for another haircut. Shelby, stay in touch with Fez.
Yes.
That's an important thing to do. All right?
Stay in touch to the hip.
Stay in touch to the hip, he calls it.
Yeah, connected to the hip.
We'll be right back. Had to turn it bad. It's the Ron and Fez Show.
Ron and Fez on Raw Dog.
Comedy Hits.
Channel 99.
Bust down a country road. Oh, going in the wind behind an old truckload. Up before the rooster crow. There's an old dog staring at the dust down a country road.
Adam Carolla is in studio with us. The new movie, Road Hard, in theaters and on demand. Go to adamcarolla.com for all the information. First of all, congratulations.
Thanks, Ron.
Not an easy thing to pull off.
No. And thanks for just playing the music from the movie.
Well, the music is great, but the scene that this is from, the depression of business traveling. Like when you're a kid, we all want to travel.
Right.
But traveling for work is a completely different experience.
Yeah, and you know, the thing that's sort of ironic about it is if you're a comic, you don't want to stay at an expensive hotel. You're basically, as a comic, a road comic, you're getting on a plane and you're going to Addison, Texas, or you're going to Denver, or you're going to Atlantic City, wherever you're going there to pick up some money and bring it home.
Right. That's
what you're doing.
Yeah.
And everybody tries to turn it into art and everything else. And look, the bottom line is, it's great. The fans are great. Doing jokes are great. Being up on stage is great. But the reality is you're getting on that plane to go pick up some money and bring it home.
Yeah.
And if you want to fly first class instead of Southwest, and you want to stay at the Ritz instead of the Red Roof Inn, that's fine, but you're going to come home with a smaller bundle of money.
Right.
And you're only going out to get the money and bring it home. So, you know, my character in the movie and me in real life is like, let's slum it. Let's take the Southwest flight. We don't need first class because we're only going for a couple days and we're only going to bring home money.
Yeah. And that's the thing. Like, you come up with this premise that if you were younger and heard about this life, you would be like, yes, I will take this in a heartbeat. But we all, as we get older, would prefer comfort. We would prefer not having 23 hours a day to kill in a strange town.
Right.
It is work. It's actually work to travel.
Yeah, and the main thing that I was saying in the movie, in that scene where I said, look, if you would have tapped me on the shoulder when I was 25 and said, you get to stand up and tell jokes for a living,
right,
I would have jumped on it, was before my character had a bunch of success on television and in movies and all these other venues, then to go back to the road was a step backwards. So, you know, it's kind of thing, it's all relative, but it was all about the step backward. We all know guys who did radio who made, you know, millions of dollars, you know, doing the morning thing, whatever. Yeah. You had a $5 million contract, whatever it was. And now at some point, that dude is doing afternoon drives and he's making $300K.
Yeah.
And that dude is miserable because that dude remembers making $3 million for doing a morning show. And now he's making $300K for doing afternoon drive. But think about the people that are listening in the car while he's talking, that long haul trucker. If you pulled that guy aside and said, listen, you don't have to wake up until about noonish every day. Your time slot is going to be about 3 o'clock to 6 o'clock in the evening. You work 3 hours a day. You don't have to prepare. You spin a bunch of records. You play a bunch of commercials. You talk a little bit in between and you're out of there by six in the evening and you get six figures to do that. That long haul trucker would be pretty excited about that gig.
Yeah, and that's true of everything, because normally in show business itself, there's only about three or four jobs that people really admire. You know what I mean? You're going to look Letterman, you're going to look at Stern, and everybody else who's not Letterman or Stern who's going, this is shit. You know what I mean? Like, that's what we do to ourselves. But there's only a handful of jobs, like, even for movie stars. Movie stars who got movies coming out every year will look over at, I don't know, Tom Cruise or Brad Pitt and go, what? Why can't I have a fucking life like this?
You know, I have a friend who passed away who was a really sweet guy, and he juggled, and he made his living as a juggler. He was an entertainer. He opened for Andy Williams for a million years. He ended up moving to Branson, Missouri, and so on and so forth. And his name was Philip. And he would say to me every once in a while with like a bunch of regret, like he'd say, he wasn't bitter, but he would say, you know, I really envy you because like you went to Hollywood and you made it happen. You got your TV shows, you got your syndicated radio shows, you have your platforms, you know, your books and bestsellers and all that. And I'm just juggling, you know, 20 minutes a night. Oh, and I said to him, I said, Philip, you understand you haven't had a job, a regular job, in 25 years. You work 20 minutes a day. You play golf all day. You live in a nice house. You have a beautiful family. You made a shitload of money, and you don't even work. You realize how you've defied the odds?
Yeah.
You haven't had a job in 25 years. You work 20 minutes a day and make thousands of dollars. Don't beat yourself up. You did okay.
So there's something fucking wrong with us all. There's something terribly wrong with us.
There's something wrong with us in that, but there's also something very... Look, it's America, and it's not all bad. The point is we shouldn't all be sitting in our station in life being miserable no matter what we're doing. But we shouldn't stop looking down the road, you know. Mm-hmm. I race cars on occasion, and sometimes there'll be 40, 45 cars in one of my races. And, you know, I'll be in 11th place and I'll be thinking, I got to get past this guy in front of me. I got to get past. Right now, there's 33 people behind me that are thinking the same thing about me and I'm not thinking about them. And maybe I just passed two of them. But all I'm thinking about is I want to get past this guy. And that's an instinct. I mean, that's natural. And the day you're not looking at that guy's taillights thinking, I got to get past this guy, is the day you should probably get out of the car. On the other hand, let's not be miserable in 11th place.
Right. We got to learn that it's a game that we're playing and we want it. We signed up for the game. We want to play the game, but be happy that we're in the game. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. there is a thing of, well, you know, you go through, by the way, the list of people that you have in this movie are ridiculous because everybody is great. I am a gigantic Larry Miller fan.
Me too.
And I think that he's just so funny in every, you'll see him in a kid's movie and he's hilarious. But I don't know if I've ever seen him as crazy and as funny as he is in this film.
Yeah, well, that's a great compliment because he's done so much good work and he's been so funny in so many different environments. You know, he's been, you know, from Pretty Woman as the, you know, kiss ass store clerk to 10 Rules to Dating My Daughter, whatever it was. I mean, where he's playing a dad, you know, it's like when he's in whatever role he's in, he's great, as he proved in this. But this is I wanted him to like really have fun and really kind of just be out there.
Yeah, he was.
And just kind of riff. If he felt like saying something, say it and swear and, you know, just be crazy baby doll, crazy Hollywood agent.
I'm gonna certainly steal baby doll when I talk to people now. But even what he's wearing on his head, everything about it is just so funny and, you know, just the cuffs are off. He's just going for it. But you got a lot of people, Phil Rosenthal, who is another guy who had enormous success in his, you know, in his job. But you see him now going, where is the next thing? You know what I mean? Which is funny.
I mean, Phil's set for life because Phil created Everyone Loves Raymond. But, you know, Phil said to me the other day, his last project starred Billy Crystal and Robin Williams. Obviously, when Robin was with us, he had a TV project that starred Billy goddamn Crystal and Robin fucking Williams. And like they passed. And Phil Rosenthal. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's like the climate we're in today, you know, like the guy who creates Everyone Loves Raymond has an idea that stars Robin Williams and Billy Crystal. And they're like, what else you got? So it's on every level. It's out there.
And, you know, the pieces come up that being funny is not enough, which I also thought was really interesting. But when you look back over your life, is that where the regrets are or the business stuff or...
I don't have enough self-esteem or self-awareness or whatever to have regrets, like business-wise, career-wise. Mm-hmm. I never think, what if, you know, or I should have, or I could have, you know, I just not wired that way. Maybe I should be. Like, maybe I'd be better. Maybe I'd be further along. I don't know. I never think that way. I think, what's next? I never sort of have the regrets. But in the movie, I wanted to make it clear that it's not the funniest guys that always make the most money. You know, there's a lot of guys out there. We all know them. Who just are funny as hell, just can't make it, just can't hook it up, just can't get it to work. Usually they're their own worst enemy.
Sure.
But, you know, and then we all know guys that are out there that are like, hey, you come up with a catchphrase called get her done, and, you know, you make $40 billion, you know? And Larry the Cable Guy, God bless him. Like, God bless everybody who's out there doing it. But what I'm saying is, it isn't the funniest guy who wins this race.
Sure.
It's the guy who plays it smart, works hard, plays the game, understands who not to piss off.
Yeah, it's a chess game like every other business.
Yeah.
But the thing is, to be funny already means that you're not good at that type of thing. Like, most people were that shitty, creepy kid in school that, you know, the guidance counselor in the early days would say, come on, you could do better. In the later days was telling people not to hang out with them. You know, that's the funny guy.
Well, yeah. Now, the thing is when you do get that rare combination of super funny with super hard work ethic meets some form of sobriety.
Yeah, right.
Mild sobriety.
Yeah.
Then you end up with Jimmy Kimmel or Howard Stern.
Yeah.
That's funny guy meets hardworking guy meets non-self-destructive, you know, guy's going to be a pill popper or whatever. You know, that's when you then get those guys.
And when you can also appear to be a regular guy after getting that kind of success. It's always amazing to me that people that I know have just tens of millions of dollars can walk into a room in regular clothes and not be Prince or even Eddie Murphy, you know?
Right.
Not have just suddenly matched the lifestyle. Mm-hmm. That they're, Louis C.K. will come in here, just be a regular guy, and you would not realize, oh yeah, he's running his entire empire.
Right.
You know, looking like that.
Yeah, it's, you know, part of it becomes your persona too. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, I always say, I mean, and maybe Prince gets caught up in his own persona
right.
of being a narcissistic douchebag, and maybe Louis C.K. gets caught up in his persona being a sort of schlubby every guy.
Yeah.
But I prefer the schlubby every guy. But, you know, there's a reason Michael Moore dresses like an out-of-work lesbian trucker when he has $50 million right. in the bank, because no one wants to hear what he has to say about wealth distribution when he's sitting on top of $50 million.
Yeah,
you know?
He's in some giant house, smoking a cigar, drinking scotch. You know, he can't ever be seen doing that.
And yeah, he has to wear the sweat jacket with the hoodie and the trucker's cap so he can be one of us.
But see, that's the thing. It's a 24-hour-a-day job when you're a public person.
Yeah, I mean? And I do believe, by the way, the Louis C.K.'s and the Jimmy Kimmels and those guys are just, they're just those guys.
You know? Right.
They're just who they are.
But the fact that they don't embrace the next step of like a basketball player would, like suddenly dating models and driving around in a Lamborghini, that I think a lot of times what happens is guys in comedy, they make it a little later, so they kind of know who they are more than, you know, sports stars.
Yeah. No, it's a pretty good point, which is when you're in a boy band or you're Shaquille O'Neal and you're 7'2" in the eighth grade, things are going to happen fast.
Right.
And when you're Louis C.K., I mean, for the love of Christ, that guy used to do my radio show in 08, 09. And my program director would come in and go, like, do we have to have this guy on again?
Yeah, you know? Right.
And so, I mean, when you don't make a nickel until all your hair falls out, you're pretty set in who you are.
Yeah.
But also, you know, success means something to different people. You know, Jimmy Kimmel doesn't want a Bentley and he doesn't want to bang Paris Hilton. Although I have to, don't quote me on that. I got to check on that. I'm not sure. I haven't spoken to him about it. But he does want to go fly fishing with Huey Lewis.
Uh-huh.
And Huey Lewis loves fly fishing. So it is Jimmy Kimmel's dream to go fly fishing with Huey Lewis. Maybe a humble dream to P. Diddy. But for J. Diddy, it's not, and that's what he does.
Yeah, I mean, but you also have to fly to Montana and all that stuff that people wouldn't be able to pull off on their weekends. Like Letterman, you never see Letterman talk about his Montana ranch that he's had forever. You know, he shows up and he's in a bad mood, and
sure,
there's
sure.
no.
No, I love it when these guys like, you know, when the guy shows up and, you know, he's interviewing some celebrity and, you know, he says, that's a nice suit. And the guy says it costs $4,000. Yeah. And Letterman goes, oh, it's a little rich for my blood. Like, really? Out of the $30 million you make a year, you can't carve out $4,000 for some threads? Okay.
And you've been making that kind of money for 30 years.
I think we could probably find that in the ashtray of his Viper.
And yet, you know, it does seem like Letterman is not happy. Like, I will give him that premise. I don't think he's bullshitting about being unhappy. And I'll tell you this, it's the oddest thing. You will never go into a restaurant in New York and see Letterman's picture next to the owner. And everywhere you go, you see Regis's picture. You know, Regis just had a ball with his success.
Yeah, it's an interesting thing that, you know, you can kind of go back, especially at this point of their careers, where it's sort of time to stop and reflect, you know?
Yeah.
And wonder, yeah, wouldn't it have just been funner, easier, whatever-er, to just have all those pictures up? And by the way, when you're gone, it's not like they take down the pictures of Regis.
No, they're still there.
They're still there.
They're still there. But, you know, maybe it comes down to this, Adam. People are either happy or they're not. It's up to them whether they're happy. Because a lot of times you'll be driving along, you'll see, like, I don't know, like a Mexican family, and there's like 18 of them having a picnic, and you're like, Why are they all happier than my family?
Get the fuck off my lawn.
Yeah, right. Why are you guys so happy?
Put down the salad tongs and pick up the leaf blower. I'm not paying you. Absolutely. Like, look, I got a dog, Molly. She's a blonde lab. Her tail's wagging all the time. You come into the room, you see her tail start flopping around. You know, she comes up to you. She gives you the snout and the snort and comes up to every, you know, my kid's sitting on the ground, she'll walk up to him. You know, and then there's dogs that are yapping and snapping and scratching and bitching. And it's, we're like dogs. We all know the dogs that are like literally smiling. You see dogs that like smile, and then you see the dogs that look like they're telling their owners to kill hookers, you know? Right. And that's how we are. And now here's my take on that. It's okay to be an unhappy person. That's your prerogative. That I just believe that's who you are. And sometimes it's created, you know, in the lab at home. Dad died or put cigarettes out on you or whatever he did. Or other times that's just how you're wired. But it is your obligation to not foist that on other people. So you can be unhappy. Mm. That's fine. Do it at home. When you come into work, be cordial, be polite, be whatever. You don't have to be Rip Taylor.
Yeah. Good reference.
Google that shit. But I would like you to show, you owe it to the people you work with. You goddamn owe it to your kids.
Yeah.
You owe it to your wife or vice versa to not be walking around like you want to kill yourself in front of your kids because it bums the shit out of your kids.
Yeah, everybody thinks it's so, you know, it's so important to dump their shit out on everybody else. But you can really bring, you know, you can bring a party down pretty fast.
Yeah, and you can, I grew up around really bummed out, depressed parents, and it made me really bummed out and depressed. Yeah. And I just don't want that for my kids.
But even also with your kids, you can only take so much credit for whether they're cool or not. You know what I mean? Like, there's a lot of people that go around like, because they raised a decent person, they're like, this is how you do it. But I've also seen really nice families with a maniac.
Yeah.
You know, a maniac that just grew up with them. That was basically like a Manson.
Right.
And you're like, well.
Yeah, yeah.
It's luck.
Yeah, I mean, look, everybody do what you can do to raise the best citizen you can.
Right.
And every once in a while, one of them's going to shoot up his school. But here's what I don't want to find. I don't want to find a bunch of skulls with candles in them in the fucking kid's room with the black curtain and the duvetine hanging there and a pentagram made out of goat's blood. then I'm going to be pissed at the parent.
Then the parents got to step in. The movie, and you can check this out, of course, by going to adamcarolla.com. New movie, Road Hard, opens in theaters. It's funny. It's thoughtful. It's really cool that you were able to pull this one off, too. So congratulations.
Well, thanks for watching, and thanks for enjoying it.
I'll see you next time coming through.
Absolutely.
So that's Adam Carolla. His new film that he's done is Road Hard, R-O-A-D, Hard. And you can check that out on adamcarolla.com. Fez, have you watched Road Hard?
I haven't seen Road Hard yet.
Can I tell you something? The reason why I think that you like the Will Forte so much and that you talked with him is because you watched his thing first. I think if you watch some of these, you might want to jump into the conversations.
That's a very good theory.
Thank you.
I should.
And I want to tell you something else about this Road Hard. And I'm willing to say it now in front of the world. I believe it's a better film than Top 5. Yeah. And I say that easily.
Wow.
So, yeah, put that shocking news out there to the world, Chubb. Did you watch Top 5?
I did.
Did you watch Road Hard?
I have not seen it yet, but
what happens with this team that we do not watch the work of the people coming in? I hope you guys have listened to Kate Pierson.
I haven't listened to Kate Pierson's new record.
No, you know she's coming in, right?
Yes.
Does that mean you're not going to jump in with her?
No, I don't know what to say to Kate Pierson.
Do you know what? Did you know what to say to Adam Carolla?
No, I didn't.
Do you know what to say to me?
That I should have watched the movie and listened to the album.
That's funny. I'll tell you something right now. I might be crazy when I say this. I prefer the Bandit. I thought the Bandit was much more confident, cocky, and ready to go.
The mustache sure was darker. That probably helped.
I thought it made him look so young.
Yeah.
I thought that he looked like a young Italian girl. So anyway, the Adam Carolla film Road Hard. Shelby, are you going to watch it over the weekend?
Yeah, I've been looking forward to it. There's so many great names in it.
You know what? They're all buddies of his, and there's so many great people who... Well, you know, let me just say this, because I brought up Phil Rosenthal with him. Phil Rosenthal is, when I was a kid, the way I thought all Jewish people I met in show business would act. And Phil seems to be the last. You know, where he's got that, you know, I tried to take care of it for you, and I'm trying to... You know, it's like that real old school Jewish thing. And now Jewish friends of mine just go like this, oh, shit, I forgot to go to temple. And I'm like, that's not what I'm looking for. I'm looking for real old New York to the mountain Jews. From the mountain to the walls, till the sweat comes off your balls. I think that's the way that that song went. Coming up a little later, and I was talking to Corporate Chris about this, and he's a big fan of this. Leeds is a big fan. Kate Pierson, guitars and microphones. Oh, what's the name of that? Is it Kate's what? I told you I stayed at earlier today on the Bennington show. Kate's Lazy something. Lazy...
Wait, Kate's Lazy Meadow.
Kate's Lazy Meadow. Does she still own it? It's this really funky, cool campground up in the Woodstock area. It's got these bizarre trailers, cool cabins. You kind of feel like you're staying in a Tim Burton movie, you know?
There's also Kate's Lazy Desert on the west coast. The meadow's on the east. So
I've never been there. I've never been. You know, as a matter of fact, when I did go to Kate's Lazy Meadow, I don't think I was. I don't think there was a west coast then. Now that's something I want to do. I want to be the first person that goes to both. like when people try to eat a Ron Bennington's cupcake at all the different places. So why don't you bring that up to her? As if you're looking for something to bring up to Kate.
I don't know how I would work the cupcakes into the conversation.
You'd just be like, hey, do you ever notice the people that go to all your lazy meadows and your lazy desert, they're like the same kind of people who eat Ron Bennington cupcakes at all the different locations?
That works.
You know what would work? Listen to the album, watch the movie, feel something about it, and then interact with those people.
That should totally be the plan.
That is the plan. And you know what the plan's called?
No.
Radio. I wanted to, you know what? Here's the weird thing. Now that Opie and Adam are friends again, you're odd man out. How would have ever thought of all the people that are odd man out of this? And then Adam's been on Anthony's show. He's been with all of us, except for you, Fez.
Yeah, I haven't talked to him. Even the last time he was here with us.
It's the Ron and what show?
Fez.
So who should be talking?
Ron and Fez.
You don't want to?
I'm just not sure what to say.
Would you rather have we have no guests on the show? Would that be better?
No, the guests are very interesting and the interviews are fantastic.
Well, why not get involved? They love when you're involved.
Yeah, it's just freezing up and not knowing what to do.
Well, you know what? I would probably freeze up if I never watched anybody's movies or listened to their albums. I'd probably be like, I don't know what you're doing here right now. I have no idea what you're doing in this room. But now I do have an idea because I've seen their movie. I'm like, oh, they're here to promote their movie or their album. Like Adam wouldn't stop by or Kate wouldn't stop by unless they had something to talk about.
Yeah, that's true.
Thanks.
And I'm sure they'll have a lot to say about their projects.
My new thing is seeing if I can hold my breath through all that for most of it. And they just exhaled. I'm going to guess there's a lot going on over there right now, but I'll get to it later. Kate Pearson's debut solo album, Guitars and Microphones, that's available in stores and on iTunes and on Twitter. She's at the Kate Pearson, at the Kate Pearson. Maybe we should do a first responders for this, Fez. We got anything?
Yeah, we'll have some B-52 CD or the brand new album signed.
What's the B-52 CD?
I don't have it with me. It's in the office. I got to grab it before she comes in.
I'm not going to play any B-52s. I'm just going to play her new album. When I used to work in Terrestrial, people would come in, they would have a new solo album, but we would just play their old classic hits. But now I don't have to do that because Satellite. And Satellite's going into the sky. The new album is Guitars and Microphones. We could do a first responders, and I want to make sure that this is the correct thing on here. At the Kate Pearson, at the Kate Pearson is what we have up here, and we'll have the new CD for first responder signed at the Kate Pearson. The Athens Band, there was a very short period of time where in the early 80s, where Athens kind of foreshadowed Seattle as far as being this town that wasn't in one of the big media centers that suddenly multiple bands broke out of. And the B-52s were part of it. Hard to believe how long the B-52s have been around, and hard to believe just how happy that music makes people. People are just, I'll just say it, mad. Mad for that music. I got to kill 6 more minutes before she gets here, Big Cat. I don't know. Is there anything you want to talk about or get involved in at all?
Well, I know that before I even knew who the B-52s were at college, the Rock Lobster song was just gigantic. Any party I went to, somebody put on that song.
Well, you know, it's funny. I was saying this today during Bennington. It still plays at weddings. Like, if you go to a wedding, Rock Lobster will pop on now, and everybody will get up and dance to it. Somewhat ironically, but oddly, even when the song came out, people felt ironic about it. Like, during the 80s, when that song was out, we'd be dancing around going like this. The 80s are nuts, aren't they? The 80s were just so crazy. And then you would go, wait, what do you mean were? It's now. And you go, oh, I thought we were just dressing this loud and bright as a joke. We mean it? And then we'd have to say to each other, yeah, we do mean it. And don't our own of our movies awful? And then we'd be like, yeah, but not as bad as the movies are going to be in the 20-teens. They're really going to be full of suckage. Because we lived in a timeline that went back and forth because we all had DeLoreans.
Nice.
Nice.
It's like,
yeah.
Predestination. Have you heard of that movie? It's like a new Australian time traveling movie.
And give it to me.
Blows like all the. It's with Ethan Hawke, who's like great in it, and it has another actress.
Oh, I did see it.
Who should have been nominated for an Oscar for this? It, way better than nearly like ever. She's playing a man a woman.
Well, don't give that away, dude. For the people who haven't seen Predestination, Chris and I talked about that a lot before when Corporate Chris used to do the show, and we made sure not to fuck up the spoiler.
I thought they gave it away in the trailer.
But if you're talking to people now, they're not watching the trailer. By the way, Ethan Hawke is always phenomenal. But yes, it was exactly what the 80s were like. It was like being Ethan Hawke all the time.
They sound pretty great if I get to be Ethan Hawke all the time.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, we got Kate Pierson up and ready to come in. Her debut solo album, Guitars and Microphones. It's available in stores and on iTunes. At the Kate Pierson for your first responders. We've got signed Kate Pierson from her new album. And as I said, I was talking about this with Corporate Chris, and we're both fans of the album. It's very new for me. You know, I've only heard it go through like once or some of the songs twice. So it always takes a while for the music to sink into me. But the sound, the fact that she hasn't lost her voice or that energy at all is just amazing. Guitars and Microphones, available in stores and on iTunes. Go to at the Kate Pierson First Responders Contest, and let's bring in Kate Pierson. Let's throw down the roses from Guitars and Microphones, Kate Pierson's brand new album. Kate, welcome.
Thank you.
Nice to see you. And it's hard to believe this is your first solo.
I know.
You've been making music in so many different places. What kept the solo from happening all this time?
I guess I just finally gave myself permission to do it. I wanted to do it for so long, and I made several. Well, I wrote a whole bunch of songs in the past and mm-hmm. nearly put them out, but then the B-52s started writing Funplex, and so it's finally the B-52s have taken a break. And we haven't toured much at all in the past year. A couple of shows here and there. And we actually do have a couple of shows in Florida next week. But we've basically slowed down. And so this gave me an opportunity to do this album finally. And I think I finally just said to myself, you just got to do it. And also my partner, Monica, was instrumental in having me get it out there. Because that was my fear. It's like I could write the songs. I'm a pretty mm-hmm. prolific songwriter, but I had this fear of actually, how am I going to get it out to the world?
So what did Monica do to drive this?
Well, first of all, Monica planted the seed in Sia to suggest to her that she could help me get this thing started, and really just do it. So we were on vacation in Tulum with Sia, and Monica suggested that to her, and she said, sure, she'd be glad to do that. So we actually went out to L.A. with our two dogs, Athena and Zeus, And Monica and I flew out there with the dogs, with their little sort of, well, they had their special dog, you know, vests on. And we flew in first class. And the whole time, I didn't even sit back once because I was so afraid they would lunge because they were really not service dogs. But anyway.
It's just a dog with a vest more than a service dog.
Two big German shepherds with vests, you know. So we went out there and we started writing sessions with Sia and other people that she had written with before. And Monica also did the video. She did the album cover. She did the photographs and also helped us kind of figure out which kind of how to get it out in the world, which was through Cobalt Label Services.
Well, you know, you've always been a visual artist that plays a big part for me, for your music. And I've been to Kate's Lazy Meadow.
Oh, you have?
Yeah, wow. It is so fantastic.
What room were you in?
Well, I was in one of the cabins.
Oh, great.
But then I kept looking over at the trailers. Like, every time I would walk by, I'm like, maybe, you know, I've never had that trailer experience. But when I look at this, it looks like you would have been in the Lazy Meadow doing this. Like, that whole, I don't know how you visually tie up something with the way your music sounds, but you're able to do that.
Well, the whole thing has been a very organic process where Monica, we didn't fuss over it too much. I kind of like mined stuff in my closet. What am I going to wear? And she took the photographs. She always takes the best photographs of me. And I was just felt totally relaxed. And the music, writing the music with Sia was, we really had fun and we laughed a lot. And, you know, it was just, at first I was a little bit daunted about going on a writing session with another person that I didn't know. See, I knew, but then it would be like Nick Valenci and it would be Chris Braid and Dallas Austin. And it just turned out to be this magical experience every time. We got a great song and a demo each time. But that whole process felt very organic because, you know, we were friends and...
Yeah, but you are right. There's always these type of things is like reminds you of like when your parents would take you to school. They're like, no, you're going to enjoy it. You're like, I don't think so. You know what I mean? You're always pushing back. But once you get the things, you can enjoy it. But it's waiting to get to those spots that feel so unpleasant.
I remember when my mother took me to kindergarten and I cried. I like balked like a mule and I dug my heels in. Mm-hmm. And I cried and this other girl came up to me and said, it's going to be all right.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was so great. And when anyway, that, it was kind of like that.
Yeah, it's life-changing when you feel that thing of, okay, it did click in. This is what I want to do.
Exactly. Yeah.
But see, I think that people don't understand this about performers, that you're just as nervous. When people go, I'd be too nervous to go out there.
Oh, yeah.
You're just as nervous. But then you got to walk through that thing. It's walking through that makes it happen.
I just finished a guest of the band stint with the Seth Meyers show with Fred Armisen with the HG band. It was, and that was kind of, whoa, I've never done this before. It's one of the most fun things I've ever done to be on the TV and do the kind of be part of that band and perform some of my songs just in the intros and outros and the guests walk on and we do a little improv thing. It was very freeing to know, you know, we could do that.
Kind of. Well, you also have that body of work now too that people know.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Like Candy.
Yeah, you've done with so many different people. You know, I was telling some of the kids that work for me here, interns and stuff, I go, when I was younger, Athens is what Seattle later became. Like, people would hear the Athens band.
Right.
And, like, I'm like, I don't know where Athens is at the time, but, like, I really feel like I want to go there because there's so much creativity coming out of there.
And the amazing thing was when B-52 started there, there was nothing. There were, you know, there was no scene.
Right.
There were two feed stores and, you know, farmer's hardware. It was really like a farm town.
Yeah.
And the University of Georgia was very separate. And, of course, it was an art school, but we weren't really art school students. That's what everyone thought. We were either English, or Cindy and I were drag queens, or we were from art school. None of the above. But, you know, Athens really was, we formed the band to have our own fun, to have something to do, really, basically. And there were no places to play. There was a folk club. So we had to go, we played a house party at first, and then we played a couple of other house parties, and then we went to New York.
But then after that was Pylon and REM and that whole thing started to come out of there.
Where, and it was the time, too.
Yeah.
It was the sort of time when everyone was, it's punk. We can do a band. Everyone can do a band.
Right. But then that kind of ushered in an 80s sound. You know what I mean? Like it really went from the way punk and new waves sounded in the 70s into the 80s. So yeah. You guys were very instrumental in being in one of those spots that changes time, you know?
Yeah, I think the key to that was, you know, the idea that you could do it yourself. And I think with this album, Guitars and Microphones, that was the key to this, too. It was kind of a do-it-yourself. You know, we had our studio in Woodstock where Monica and I, you know, we sort of hatched this whole project doing the video there. And Fred Armisen is in the video of yeah. his sister. And, you know, it was very much do-it-yourself.
You know, the album's still new to me, but the song I keep going back to is Bring Your Arms. There is so, by the way, there's so many great songs on this album. It isn't an album of like, oh, a couple songs and then filler.
Right.
But Bring Your Arms is the one that jumps out to me. And I still have that feeling of when I'm younger, that when you're listening to an album, which are going to be your initial connections.
It's funny because everyone has a different song they connect yeah. to. A lot of people are connecting to Guitars and Microphones, but that song, Bring Your Arms, Sia wrote for me with Chris Braid. And when she, before we started our writing project, she was writing for herself mm-hmm. and she said, oh my God, you know, I've written a song for you. I didn't even know. It was just about our vacation that Monica and Sia and I took in Tulum, and we witnessed the sea turtle rescue. And she sent that song, and I just was like, oh my God, I love this song. And it's something I feel like she has the ability to zero in and write something for me that it was so felt so personal. I felt like I had written it, you know. So she's so intuitive, and she tuned in to me, to my soul, really, and was able to, you know, she wrote that song, which was the beginning of this whole project. And she wrote three songs before we actually started collaborating.
So that's even for you, I guess it comes to you the same way. Like if a song comes up, whether you write it or someone else,
yeah.
you're like, is this song going to hang around?
I think, yeah, some people are given songs that other people write for them and they're like, well, I don't really like it, but people say it's going to be a hit. Try
yeah.
it. But this once, you know, was like, oh, yeah, I love this song. I love it.
There is something so mysterious to
yeah.
a song, you know? The way they come into the world, the way they mature, it's a very strange thing.
It is, and it's very, you know, much letting your subconscious and tapping into the collective unconscious and, you know, letting all that flow. It's, you know, relaxing and feeling free, and that's where the sensibility of the B-52 started with, too. Make your own fun, let's jam, let's just let it flow, let's not censor ourselves. That was a key thing. Don't, you know, start second-guessing yourself and thinking, oh, that's not right, that's not good. You know, just let
right.
it flow.
So that's always the point of songwriting, is to get out of your own way. To,
exactly.
To yeah. let it happen. Something else I love on the album, too, and I love, because I'm not used to you doing ballads, but Pulls You Under. It's a great way to end the album. How come you haven't done more ballads? Is it because it's always been a group situation?
B-52s do not do ballads.
Yeah. So if a ballad comes up with you guys, you're like, no, we got to keep the party going.
I don't think we've ever really even had the sort of thought of doing a ballad. No, we're a party band.
Right.
You know, we started as a dance band to have fun, and pretty much we've kept the party going.
So this gives you an opportunity to go places that you've never gone before.
Exactly. Yeah, I think yeah. this is my opportunity to really express myself mm-hmm. and the things otherwise I wouldn't be doing a solo record if I didn't have something to say beyond the B-52s. And I feel like that kind of heartfelt, soulful thing that I wanted to express in my own way, you know, mm-hmm. I was able to do it with this. And it just feels so great to do that.
Do you still connect with this B-52s in the same way, with that whole scene, the same way when you were a kid? Or has it changed for you over the years?
I feel like a lot of times we've almost come back full circle to this kind of feeling like, wow, it's sort of magical, what, you know, realizing, okay, what we've done and how other people were helped by, you know, so many people come up and say, you helped me through high school, you changed
right.
my life, we saw you on Saturday Night Live, and it was amazing, and we had no intention of doing that, or, you know, we didn't have a goal, like, let's make people happy, you know,
right.
just like to make us ourselves amused and happy. And I think seeing that and seeing how the audience reacts and how much fun they have, and I just feel like it's such a gift, and it's almost like this rebirth, because when we do it, a lot of young kids are coming to a concert and not, you know, forced by their parents. They're actually coming. You know, I see a real mixed bag of the audience. So that's thrilling. And the audience is still electric. So it gives me a charge.
I do think there's that thing of, you know, helping people through different times, because the band kind of embraced being weird before that was okay to be weird.
And we just were weird, so we didn't even have to embrace it.
But I've always said this to people. I go, you're never going to really have a band unless it's a weird cool. Like, you always, a band that you're into, you're like, boy, I don't know what that person does when they walk off the stage. I don't know how, I can't imagine seeing Prince at the supermarket. You know what I mean? Like, that's what I've always loved in a rock star.
Yeah, it's... It's a mystery because, well, when we wore our wigs and we had our hairdos and our, I mean, we did that as an extension of going to parties and what we kind of wore just to have fun. But it was also kind of a empowering disguise because you could put a wig on and then you know, could sort of beam yourself onto the stage and feel like a little bit protected. Mm-hmm. So you could do whatever because you know, that wasn't in some ways your everyday self.
What I loved about it, too, is I remember being a kid and when the girl group thing, like Ronnie Spector, and I just thought that there was nothing higher than that type of music, you know?
It's beautiful.
Ronnie Spector comes in here now, and
I love her voice. It's just like...
It is amazing.
Tingling, inducing.
And you know what's funny about Ronnie? It's like she has never gotten it. She doesn't know that you and I would just start talking about Ronnie Spector out of somewhere. So she would always be like, oh, they know who I am. And I'm like, what, are you crazy? Do you know what it is to be Ronnie Spector?
I think most artists have a kind of self-effacing or, you know, insecure aspect. And like when I did this record, I also felt like, oh, are people going to like it? You know, I didn't have any idea.
Well,
I knew I liked it. That's the main thing, is I wanted to do this solo record and I felt like, oh, this is something I feel really good about.
Well, the record's terrific and God bless you. Your voice is amazing in this as well. Guitars and microphones. Let's go out with Bottoms Up. Is that okay if we do that? But
that
congratulations on this. And I'll see you the next time coming through.
All right. Thank you.